This is Josiah Plays, Lone Wolf, Book 5, Shadow on the Sand. And as you can see, we have a new feature here. Thanks to the amazing miracles of technology available to us now in the space age, I am able to bring to you the cover of the book shown alongside the text. So the cover will be shown throughout the entire read-through, the entire video. So you can always see the cover. I don't have to switch to a separate tab to show you the cover. Pretty exciting, I'm gonna say. It took some technical know-how on my part. It was not easy, but I'm willing to put in the long, long hours of back-breaking labor at the computer for the good of my viewers. You're most welcome. But let's see. Let's read a little intro here, shall we? You are Lone Wolf, last of the Kai Lords. A voyage to Vasagonia promises an end to the shadow of war. But hopes are soon shattered upon your arrival at Barakish, a city full of treachery and death. In Shadow on the Sand, you are the quarry of a sinister foe, determined to kill you at all costs. Choose your skills and your weapons carefully. They can help you survive and aid you in the quest for a lost Somlending treasure. A treasure that contains the secret of your destiny. Wow, it sounds like things are getting serious. Alright, so then taking a look at this cover here. I remember this one very well. Of course, this is again the American, original American release cover of this book. It was released in the UK before that with a different cover, but this was the cover that I had when I owned this book, Shadow on the Sand. I always loved this cover. It's so exciting. He's up on top of a flying beast. His sword is on fire. He's fighting what looks like a hell gas there, chopping his weapon in half, and they're up in the air. I mean, what a dynamic, exciting-looking battle that is. Also like the way they changed the font slightly on the actual title of the book itself. But yeah, this one's cool. As you can see, it says that it's like a special super edition, including two adventures. Now, that's kind of true. It does include two sections, two separate parts. And combined, they are longer than a normal Lone Wolf book, but not much longer. A normal Lone Wolf book, all the others have 350 numbered sections. Whereas this is divided into two parts of 200 sections each. So it is a little longer than a normal book. It's two sections of 200, but it's not as long as really two books, which would be 700 sections total. So it's not like really a whole double book. It's just a little bit longer than the other books. Nonetheless, it's gonna be fun. These books were written by Joe Deaver back in the 80s, and originally illustrated by Gary Chalk. The music that you're hearing is by Kevin MacLeod. All the music you'll hear through this video is by him. You find him at incompetech.com. Links to him are below in the description if you're watching this on YouTube. Watching on Twitch, well, you're gonna have to look it up yourself. Moving forward, we've got all the acknowledgements and such, and now we have the story so far. You are Lone Wolf, last of the Kai Lords of Somerland, and sole survivor of the massacre that destroyed them during a bitter war with your age-old enemies, the Dark Lords of Helgadad. It is midwinter in your northern homeland, and a mantle of snow lies knee-deep in the streets of Holmgard, the capital, when you are summoned from your monastery in the hills by a messenger bearing a scroll, signed and sealed by the hand of King Olnar. You are surprised to ring the king's message, for it is a request for your help in solving an urgent problem of what he describes as great diplomatic importance. I'm not really surprised to get a call request for help. That's happened several times now. But diplomatic, huh? It seems a strange request to make of a warrior lord, whose skills are better suited to the field of battle than to parleying with foreign envoys. However, you obey the summons, and upon your arrival at the capital, all is made clear. The Zakan of Vasagonia, the imperial ruler of this desert empire, has sent his most trusted envoy to seek a treaty of peace between your two countries, and you have been asked to sign the treaty on behalf of your country. The reason for this is easily apparent. Now keep in mind that Vasagonia is who we were fighting in the last book. The army that we fought were Vasagonians, and we killed several of them. Less than a year ago, a renegade noble of Vasagonia called Baraka led his army of bandits in an attack upon the Somlending province of Ruinon. This mining town and much of the surrounding land was overrun and destroyed. Many Somlending lost their lives, and many more were enslaved and forced to labor in the mines of the Machin Range. When the regular convoy from Ruinon failed to arrive at the capital, the king sent you to investigate. A great battle ensued in which you defeated Baraka in mortal combat. Without your courage and skill, the safety of Somerland and all of the Last Lands would have been placed in grave peril.
Your Majesty, the Zakan is gravely embarrassed by Baraka's foul treachery, and is most anxious that our friendship and trust be restored. He begs that you send the Kai warrior Lone Wolf to sign a treaty of peace with him at the Grand Palace in Barakish, whimpers the Zakan's emissary as he kneels at the feet of King Olnar.
The king rises from his throne, barely able to conceal his distaste for the fawning envoy. He turns his gaze to you and bids you follow him to the privacy of an antechamber.
I have no liking for this desert realm, Lone Wolf. But I like the prospect of war even less. The Zakan is old and frail, and has no son to claim his throne when he dies. Baraka was but one of many ruthless nobles who wait like jackals for the chance to seize power, and I fear they grow too impatient to allow the Zakan to die a natural death. The treaty may not guarantee peace with Vasagonia once the Zakan is dead, but it will at least buy us precious time to strengthen our southern border.
The king leads you to a window and points towards a harbor, barely visible through the falling snow. A Vasagonian galley lies anchored close to the harbor wall.
Go to Vasagonia, Lone Wolf! Sign the treaty and return quickly! Even with the promise of peace, I fear the shadow of war will fall upon us before the year is out.
You wave farewell to home guard on this bleak midwinter's day, feeling sure you will return before the thaw. But as you watch the spires of home guard disappear in the falling snow, you have no inkling of the shadow that awaits you in Vasagonia. Shadow on the sand, one might say. Well, this sounds like a trap. They asked for me by name. They're like, could you send Lone Wolf down here alone by himself to our base? That'd be great. We don't mean him any harm or anything. Alright, well, hopefully we can prevent a war. You know, that's a good thing to do. Game rules, this is not changed. Everything carries over. I get one more new bonus Kai discipline. There's only two left that I haven't taken. So this time I'm going to take Mind Blast. This enables a Kai Lord to attack an enemy using the force of his mind. It can be used at the same time as normal combat weapons. It adds 2 extra points to your combat skill. Not all the creatures encountered on this adventure will be harmed by Mind Blast. You will be told if a creature is immune. So I'll check that. Equipment. Before leaving Home Guard on your voyage to the Vasagonian capital of Barakish, you're given a map of the Desert Empire. Let's check the map out. The Empire of Vasagonia. Alright, so here we have the corner of the lands we were in last time, basically. There's Farufazan again. We saw their banner on the last map. And then as we look over here, we can see Barakish. That's where we're headed. And a whole lot of desert. And so forth. Empire of Vasagonia. I realize you can't see all of it because of the book cover, but what can you do? The Empire of Vasagonia is a vast desert realm. The northern coast runs roughly east for several hundred miles before it turns in a lazy, rugged arc to the south. Roughly at the apex of this arc is the city of Barakish, the capital city of Vasagonia. The six other cities of this vast, arid country are mainly to be found in the thin coastal strip, such as Farufazan in the northwest and Bisutan in the south. Barakish is cut off from most of the rest of Vasagonia by the semicircle of the Kabar Range. These mountains meet the sea on the eastern coast at Cape Kabar, which overlooks a trio of islands. For all its magnificent coastline, Vasagonia lacks fresh water, with only six major oases in the entire realm, half of which line the trail to the south of the Dahir Mountains between Ikaresh and Birabalu. Right. Good to know. Good to know. I think we will use all of that information. Given a pouch of gold, I can't have any more gold. I'm already at 50 crowns, which is the maximum you're allowed to have. So, no more gold for me. I can take my pick up to four of the following. Dagger, a potion, a sword, a spear, rations, a mace, a shield. I already have a shield. I don't think I'm taking any of this because my backpack is already full of random stuff. In a desert, I probably won't be able to use hunting for meals, but I don't really care. I'm just gonna hold on to the stuff that I have. And not take anything new. So moving forward. Rules for combat, still the same. Levels of Kai training. I am now a savant, rank 9 of a Kai. That means after this, I become a Kai master, the highest rank. But beyond the 10 basic skills of the Kai master await the secrets of the higher Kai disciplines, or Magna Kai. So I get to become a Magna Kai. After this one, I'll be a master. Then I get to become a Magna Kai, which is kind of like when you're a Cub Scout and you get to become a Weeblo. A Weeblo. It's kind of like that, except not at all the same. Kai Wisdom always kind of says the same thing. Your mission is one of peaceful diplomacy, but beware! The Desert Empire of Vasagonia is notorious for being a land of deceit and treachery. Be on your guard at all times. Okay. Keeping that in mind. And here we've arrived at the first numbered section. Our actual adventure begins now. For 25 days, the Vasagonian galley sails on a steady course for its home port of Barakish. With only a brief stop at the Duranese harbor of Port Bax to break a safe but monotonous voyage. I've been to Port Bax before. You use your time aboard the ship to good purpose, learning the Vasagonian language from the ship's crew. You know, just spending 25 days to learn a language, no problem. They are only too eager to teach you, asking only in return tales of your adventures in the last lands. For many of the sailors, these are the most exciting stories they have ever heard. By the time you reach Barakish, you have both mastered their language and won their respect. It is early afternoon. Here we have an illustration of some spires, some minarets or whatever, and some banners. This is obviously a very Middle Eastern themed nation in the setting. It is early afternoon when the ramparts of the desert capital are first sighted on the horizon. You push your way through the cheering crew and join the envoy at the prow of the ship. Beaming with pride, he hands you a telescope and invites you to view the land of his birth. The sight is indeed breathtaking. You stare in fascination at the golden domes, minarets, and green-tiled roofs shimmering beneath the desert sun.
and marvel at the splendor of the Grand Palace, which dominates this magnificent city. Then you notice that from every golden turret of the palace flutters a long black pennant. You ask the envoy of the meaning of the black flags. Horror floods across his face as he snatches the telescope from your hands.
By the spirit of the Mahan, he is dead! The Zakan is dead!
As the bad news spreads through the ship, you pray that the peace treaty will be signed and honored by the Zakan's successor. However, the envoy is less than hopeful. Well, this does not bode well. They were all like, well, the peace might not hold up after the Zakan's already dead. I'm coming down here by myself. I know they already hate me. This does not bode well. There might be some shadows on the sand before this thing is through. The harbor of Barakish is deserted, save for a handful of citizens clad in black, and the only sound that greets you is the toll of a funeral bell echoing through the harbor on this day of mourning. Then a horse-drawn carriage enters the harbor square, escorted by the cavalry of the palace guard. It halts, and a dour man in turquoise robes steps out to meet you.
A thousand greetings, lone wolf. I am Mauk, and I welcome you to our city on behalf of my master, his most supreme magnificence, Zakan Kima.
The envoy gasps upon hearing the name of the new Zakan. He turns to speak, his eyes wild with fear.
It is a trap! You must!
His warning is cut short by the blade of Mauk's dagger. Suddenly, scores of black-clad warriors emerge from the shadows. They are Sharnazim, elite Vasagonian bodyguards. They close in, surrounding you on every side. You must act quickly if you are to survive this deadly trap. So scores of desert ninjas just rolled up and are jumping me. That sounds good. Scores is a lot. A score is 20. Scores is probably at least 3 scores. It's probably at least 60 dudes. It's a lot of dudes. I don't think I can stand and fight against these overwhelming odds. I'm not gonna surrender, though. I'm gonna run back to the galley. Bravely ran Array away!
Take him! Shouts Mauk, but take him alive!
You sprint towards the distant galley. The crew are still unaware of the desperate situation. They have not witnessed the murder of the envoy and are still oblivious to your peril. Before you can shout for help, a horseman cuts across your path, blocking your access to the ship.
I will... should I stop and fight this guy? I've got 60 plus desert ninjas running after me. Or should I dive into the sea? Fuck it, attacking the horseman.
Frantically, the warrior pulls on the reins and tries to trample you beneath the hooves of its startled horse. Note 1. Restore half of any endurance points that you lose during this combat if you win or evade. Note what happens if you lose. Alright, time for a battle. He has a lot of combat skill. 21, not bad. I have Mind Blast though, son. That makes mine 27 now. Alright, round 1. 28, 28. I lost 3, he lost 7. Round 2. I lost none. He lost, what, 18? Wow. I wrecked him that round. Round 3. 25 and 3. Yeah, I lost none and he died. Awesome. Took this horseman out. And of course, we have an image of the horseman right here. He's got his turban. He's got his scimitar. And a very obstreperous looking horse. Trying to trample me and stuff. That's rude. Alright, if I win in 3 rounds or less, it took me exactly 3 rounds, so that's good. The horse and its dead rider topple from the quayside and splash into the sea. The crew have drawn up the gangplank, forcing you to leap the gap. You fall short and land on the row of oars bristling from the galley's side. The wood is wet and slippery, and you have to fight to keep your balance. Pick a random number. If you have the Kai discipline of hunting, add 2. So I need a 4 or more.
I'm adding 2, which means I need to roll a 2 or higher. And I rolled a 7. Yes, I made it. Could have been instant death right here. I'm not sure. You managed to inch your way. Wait. Healing on those last 2. You managed to inch your way along the row of oars until you reach the ship's rail, where eager hands catch hold of your cloak and pull you to safety. Mauk's voice booms out across water.
Surrender the Kai Lord to me! The Zakan commands it! Your lives and the lives of all your kin will be forfeit if you disobey this order!
The crew stare at each other in sorrow and dismay. They know that Mauk's words are no idle threat. You cannot expect these men to sacrifice their families for you, so you must quickly decide on an alternate plan. Surrender, hells to the no, or dive overboard and attempt an escape. I'm about to lose my chainmail waistcoat again, aren't I? Well, let's dive overboard and attempt an escape. While I'm swimming, I'm going to heal myself.
You hit the water and swim submerged until the pain in your lungs forces you to the surface. Sharnazim are running in every direction, trying to surround the key and prevent your escape. Gulping another breath, you dive again and swim towards a cluster of small boats less than 50 yards away. Through the clear blue water, it is easy to see the rubbish that litters the bed of the harbor, mementos of all the merchant ships that have docked at the quayside. Clinging to one old anchor is a strange jelly-like blob. A mass of short tubes sticks out from all its sides, and a long hook-like scoop hangs beneath its rubbery body. Without warning, the blob suddenly jets towards you, propelled by water from its massive breathing tubes. It is a blood lug, and it is hungry for your flesh.
Well, I don't want to be eaten by a blood lug. I do possess the Kai discipline of animal kinship, so let's use it.
You use your Kai discipline to force the creature away. The bloodlug changes direction and jets toward a squid that has taken refuge in a large copper urn. You continue swimming, but keep a watchful eye on the bloodlug as it engulfs and devours the helpless squid.
It just ate a squid. This thing ain't messing around.
You surface beside a covered skiff. Anxious to avoid the scavengers in the waters of Barrakesh Harbor, you haul yourself aboard and hide beneath the boat's canopy of woven rushes. You are breathless from your swim, but you dare not make a sound. Mauk's men are everywhere, racing along the harbor walls, their eyes searching the water for any sign of you. If you are to escape, you must think of something to divert their attention.
I can use my Kai discipline of mind over matter here, which I do have. So let's go for that.
As you stare out across the harbor, you notice a large white-domed warehouse near to the water's edge. A platform on the upper floor overhangs a merchant dhow moored at the quay below. On this platform are several earthenware tuns, huge spice containers destined for the trading emporia of Ragadorn.
I hate that town.
You focus your attention on one of these tons and concentrate all your Kai skill into making it move. Sweat pours down your face from the strain, but you soon hear a distant crash that confirms your success. The ton has fallen and shattered on the deck of the dhow.
Success. Hopefully that distracts them.
Mauk orders his black-clad troops to search the area, threatening them with death if they allow you to escape. You bite your lip and wait for a chance to run. Creeping from one boat to the next, you reach a narrow flight of stone steps. At the top of the steps, beyond a small paved square, lies a maze of crooked alleyways that disappear into the shadows of the thieves' quarter. You are less than 20 feet from safety when a cry echoes across the water. There he is! You sprint along the deserted passage and climb a stairway into an open courtyard. The sound of hooves clattering on the cobblestones below urges you onwards. There are 3 possible exits from the courtyard: a high nail-studded gate to the left, an alley to your right, and a straight paved pathway that leads to an arch. You must make a quick decision, for Maug's men are close at your heels. I'm going to use the Kai discipline of tracking here. Your Kai sense warns you that the alley is a dead end. If you take that exit from the square, you will certainly be trapped. Only two other choices remain, the high, nail-studded gate to your left, or the path directly ahead. I'm going to take the path, because the gate could be locked, and then I could have a problem getting through it, and then I get trapped. Taking the path. You enter a wide street where vendors compete for space for their stalls beneath the overhanging balconies. The market is crowded with people. They each wear a black sash as a mark of respect to their dead Zakan, but here, unlike in most of Barakish, business continues as normal. You pass a stall festooned with black sashes, each costing 2 gold crowns. If you wish to buy a sash, pay the vendor and mark it on your action chart as a special item, which you wear over your tunic. I should buy one of these sashes, I'll blend in more. So, I got plenty of money. 2 crowns, I have 48 remaining. Now, I need to maybe do some curating of my special items here. Some of this stuff, like keys from old books, I'm never going to use those keys. That scroll with the prophecy from the last book, I'm never going to do anything with that. So let's take a black sash here. You hurry away from the stall and dodge into a narrow passage lined with eating houses and small taverns where the smell of food is mingled with the odor of stale wine and the air is alive with chatter and gossip. Your attention is drawn to a notice freshly pasted to a tavern wall. The bold headline reads, "The Zakan is dead! Long live the Zakan!" If you wish to stop to read the poster... Yeah, I'll read the poster real quick. How long can that really take? The poster is written from right to left in Fasigonian script. The time you spent learning the language aboard the galley was well spent, for you have little difficulty in translating the proclamation. His most illustrious majesty, Zakan Mudala the Exalted, has passed into the realm of the Mahan. May his spirit never die. By the grace of the Council of Kadi, the Funtal of Karakala, and the Judikar of Barakish, it is decreed that Kima, Emir of Farufazan, protector of the Dry Main, shall by right claim the throne of Vasigonia. Through the unity of the Seven Cities, he will lead his people to greatness. Long may he reign. A scuffle breaks out at the end of the passage as a handful of Sharnazim try to push their way through the crowd. In the confusion, a fruit stall is overturned, and its owner curses the clumsy soldiers at the top of his voice. Then, there is a sudden silence. The luckless man has been beheaded for his insolence. Oh, this kind of place. I just said this like 7 times in a row or something. This is this kind of place. They just behead dudes in the street if they act up. So, not exactly due process of law here. I have a feeling this is not a democracy. You turn and run, splashing through the shallow drainage channel running the length of the foul passage. And here's a picture that seems to be apropos of nothing. Just throw an illustration on the page there. It could be anything, really. How about a wing with a talon attached to it, with no body in between? Throw that on there. Shallow drainage channel running the length of the foul passage. Okay. The passage ends at a tree-lined plaza. You must find somewhere to hide. Your fair skin and your Kai cloak and tunic make you stand out in the city crowd. To your left is a small dwelling with a curious wooden sign hanging above the door, carved in the shape of a fish. To your right is a tavern. The sign above the tavern door seems oddly appropriate. The Hunted Lord. Ha! Yeah, that's pretty much perfect tavern for me, I guess. Alright. I do possess the Kai Discipline of Healing, so let's see what that reveals to me. You recognize the sign of the fish. It is the symbol of an order of monks known as the Redeemers, a silent order who are devoted to a lifetime of prayer, pilgrimage, and the study of the healing arts. Well, they sound nice.
But, I don't know, I kind of like the sound of that tavern, though. The Hunted Lord, that sounds like the place for me. I think I'm going to go in the tavern, even though the Redeemers sound nice. If I needed healing or something, maybe I'd go in there, but I don't. The tavern is crowded with people who are seated at a long stone counter, decorated with fragments of colored marble. Large earthenware jars full of spicy foods are set into the counter, and serving girls are busy attending to the hungry customers. I am wearing a black sash. Let's see if that turns out to be a good idea or a poor one.
"Come in, stranger. Welcome to my humble tavern," says the plump landlady of the eating house. "We have wine and food and rooms aplenty."
At this moment, you hear Mauk's men enter the plaza and cast an anxious glance towards the open door. The landlady sees that you are nervous. She points to the cellar stairs and says in a hushed voice,
"Do not worry. We share your fear of the new Zakan. Quickly, you must hide."
There is no time to hesitate. Mauk's warriors are already approaching the tavern. Hopefully this works out. Hopefully she's helping me because I have a black sash. Then that was a good idea to get one. The other possibility is that she's tricking me, and it's a trap, and I'm about to get killed. You rush into the cellar and bolt the door. Pressing your ear to the gnarled timber, you listen intently to the noise of Mauk's angry soldiers. They have entered the building, and it will only be a matter of time before they notice the cellar of door. The cellar of door? Notice the cellar door. You cast your eyes around the room. It is empty except for a coil of rope and a tinderbox. I already have rope, don't need a tinderbox, I have a fire sphere. Then you notice that there is another way out of the small stone room, an iron grill in the center of the floor. However, the horrible stench rising from it turns your stomach. Oh, this doesn't sound good. I can stay in the cellar and prepare for combat, but there's so many of them coming. This will probably lead to my death. Or capture. Leave the cellar by the grill means going down into the sewers. Well, you got to do what you got to do. Going down the grill. A slippery ladder disappears into the dark, stench-filled shaft. You gulp a lungful of air and climb down, locking the trapdoor behind you. When you finally reach the bottom of the shaft, your worst fears are confirmed. You have entered the Bagadaruz, the main drainage sewer of Barakish. You recall one of the crewmen aboard the galley, an old man nicknamed the Stink because he smelled so much, having been sentenced to 1 year's imprisonment in the Bagadaruz for a crime he did not commit. Peering along the gloomy tunnels, you wonder how he survived for so long in this dank, filthy sewer. Suddenly your thoughts are disturbed by the sound of splintering wood. Chunks of shattered timber rain down upon you as the Sharnazim force open the trapdoor. The heavy iron grill glances off your shoulder as it falls. You stifle a cry of pain, but you lose one endurance point due to the wound. This section of the Bagadaruz is a junction where three channels meet. You must quickly decide which channel to take, for Mauk's men are now descending the ladder. Well, this sounds like a perfect time to use tracking. Judging by the direction of the sluggish flow, the right channel appears to head off to the north. The vast tide of sewage and garbage from the Bagadaruz is swept out towards the coast until it emerges at Chiras, a village northwest of the capital. There it makes life both difficult and unpleasant for the poor local fishermen, especially during the summer months. If you take the north channel, you should eventually reach the coast. The left channel heads south
running below the very heart of the capital. In the maze of tunnels that feed into the Baga de Ruz, you should be able to find at least one exit to the streets above. Straight ahead, the channel leads off to the west. It is by far the least fetid and contaminated of the three. During the voyage, you remember the stink telling you about the Grand Madani, a great aqueduct over 40 miles long, which channels fresh water from the River Da into the city. As a result, the citizens of Barakish, unlike the inhabitants of other Vasagonian cities, enjoy a lavish supply of fresh water. The west channel will lead to that water source. So the west kind of sounds good just because it's the least contaminated, but I don't know that getting to the aqueduct really helps me so much. I kind of want to get into the maze of tunnels that lead to the streets, you know, so I can get deeper into the heart of the city. Could go to the coast too, but I don't know that I want to go to the coast exactly. I'm gonna go south. The water is clotted with a revolting variety of green and black muck and scum. It reaches up to your waist, and as you force your way through the glutinous mire, couldn't I get some gluten-free mire, please? The surface film breaks, releasing a vile gas. You have to cover your nose and mouth with your Kai cloak, for the stench is appalling. A sudden splash warns that Mauk's men are not far behind. Man, these guys are really hounding me. Your foot catches in something buried in the silt of the tunnel floor, and for one brief second you are seized by total panic. You struggle to kick free but are held fast. Blindly, you stab your weapon beneath the filthy water until your foot is finally freed. As you withdraw your weapon, you half expect to find some hideous sewer creature impaled upon it. Instead, you discover a human rib cage. You shudder and flick the bones back into the stinking mire. Yuck. The channel soon divides. The new tunnel heads west, and the other continues southwards. The splashing has grown steadily louder. Maug's men are gaining on you. I'll continue south. The water is becoming thicker, and the stench of the sewer gas increasingly more vile and nauseating. Suddenly, the air becomes choked with thousands of tiny flies, and every time you gasp for breath, you feel the thick fur of pulped bodies in your throat. Oh, that's disgusting. The black specks build up like paste around your eyes, mouth, and nostrils, and the sharp, tangy taste in your mouth makes you retch. Lose one endurance point. Yeah, lose one sanity. I would have healed this other one by now from the healing, but then I lose another one, so I'm still at 27. As if in answer to your prayers, an iron ladder appears from out of the gloom. It is fixed to the tunnel wall and leads up to a circular stone trapdoor in the ceiling. I am not pressing on in the insect choke tunnel. This is gross. The thick fur of pulped bodies in your throat. I'm gonna have nightmares. That's not good. That's no bueno right there. Now we're climbing the damn ladder and getting out of here. Now I'm healing myself. As you start to climb, two Sharnazim warriors suddenly emerge from the insect-choked tunnel. They lunge at you, their hands outstretched, their fingers hooked to claw at your legs and drag you down. You kick out and strike one of the cruel-faced men beneath the jaw. He clutches at his throat and gives a gurgling cry as he falls backwards into the slimy water. You reach the stone trapdoor, but the other warrior has unsheathed his scimitar and has begun to climb the ladder. He no longer intends to capture you alive. Pressing your shoulder to the cobwebbed trapdoor, you push up the heavy stone and scramble out to find yourself in a noisy alley, crowded with people and market stalls. The sewer hole itself is close to a wicker table stacked high with bundles of torches. Oh, that's convenient. I have a cult fire sphere, actually. Note that you don't need any of your own torches to use the tinderbox. Okay. Right, there's a table full of torches here, so I'm gonna light a torch and drop it on his face, I guess. I have a fire sphere. Let's do this. You set light to a tar-coated torch and hurl it down into the sewer hole. There is a tremendous flash and roar. Suddenly, all along the alley, plumes of flaming sewage explode skywards. The alley is transformed into a rush of shocked and screaming people, all scrambling to avoid the deluge of burning filth raining down on their heads. The torch has triggered a chain reaction in the Baga de Rouge. The inflammable sewer gas has ignited. Everywhere is panic and confusion. I just blew up a sewer. And here we have an explosion, and dude lost his hat. People aren't having fun. Lemons or limes, one of the two, are falling out of a basket. Mass chaos is raining upon the earth. Wow. Basically just created the apocalypse. You run with the crowd through the sewage-stained alleys until you reach a busy market square, unpolluted by the blast. Your eye is caught by a sign hanging above the side door of a large hall. Barakish Public Baths. You push open the door and slip inside. Yeah, I could really use a bath after all that business. You enter a large vestibule, constructed from blocks of pink and white marble. A man in a white robe sits near a door in the far wall. He is reading a scroll held close to his face. He has not seen you enter the baths, but he is quick to sense your presence. There he is, I guess. He's got a scroll. It looks like he's... I mean, not to be indelicate here, but it kind of looks like he's taking a shit. I mean, is this guy on the toilet or what? I mean, what's up with his facial expression right now? What is happening in this man's life that he's making that face? What is on that scroll? I'm just concerned by everything about this picture. Also, he's got a hell of a beard there. Reading a scroll. Yeah, that's one way of describing what's happening here. By the Mahan! He cries. You smell worse than a Baknar! He hurls a towel at you and points to the door. Take my advice! He whines, his fingers pinching shut his nostrils. Don't get undressed! Your clothes need the bath as much as you! You grit your teeth in anticipation of the moment when he sees that you are not Vasikonian. But he simply returns to his scroll, holding the parchment close to his short-sighted eyes. You smile as you realize that the man cannot see you clearly enough to know you are a foreigner. Beyond the door there is a long hall, leading at regular intervals into smaller open chambers, each with a sunken bath. This is a nice place. Perfumed water constantly splashes into the baths and drains away directly into the Baga de Rouge. You decide to take the bath attendant's advice and jump straight into the cool water, keeping all your clothes on. You notice a large earthenware jar stands beside the bath, full to the brim with a translucent purple oil. I can eat some oil, I can rub some on. I'm going to use the Kai Discipline of Healing to see if I can identify this. The oil is made from the fruit of the Larnuma tree. It has a soothing and relaxing effect when rubbed into the skin. I'll soothe and relax myself. Yeah, I'll rub in some Larnuma oil. Sounds good. You feel your muscles start to relax. The oil soothes the cuts and bruises which cover your body and restores 2 endurance points. Alright, well I didn't need that, but thank you. Having washed off the worst of the dirt, and it's not just dirt, you clamber out of the bath and enter a small antechamber. The room is hot and arid and your clothes are soon as dry as bone. Beyond the antechamber is another hall, this time crowded with people, some seated, others standing, and everyone busy in conversation. These are the free baths of Barakish, and the citizens of the capital are justly proud of them. They are the envy of the other desert cities where water is scarce and precious. The citizens treat the baths as a forum, a place for meeting and talking with friends. Much of the conversation you overhear is about the new Zakan. few speak well of him. So people aren't too happy about this, who this person that became the Zakan. I bet he's an evil bastard. You wrap yourself in the large towel and make your way through the crowd towards the main entrance. If you wish to keep the towel once you're outside, you must mark it on your action chart as 2 backpack items due to its size. What is this, Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy? Am I gonna keep a towel with me? He really knows where his towel is. I mean, I'd have to get rid of something else to have a towel. I don't know that I need a towel all that badly. Probably don't need a pick and a shovel, though. Fine, I'll get rid of the shovel and take a towel instead. Now I'm a hoopy fruit who really knows where his towel is. Which is, Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, Douglas Adams. Series of books, reference. You may know of it. Or you may just think I sound like an idiot. Which you probably think all the time, but that's neither here nor there. Let's move on. Hurrying down the steps and away from the bath hall, you enter the Sadi Tasuda, the Square of the Dead. Jet black flagstones cover the square, each with a long iron spike set deep into its center. From the bath hall steps, the square resembles the back of a massive iron porcupine. But when you reach the base of the steps, you realize that the Sadi Tasuda is in fact far more sinister. Stuck on top of each spike is a human skull, all that remains of pirates, murderers, traitors, and thieves who have been sentenced to death. The grisly display serves as a warning to others never to defy the law of the Zakan. I just want to say, I was really young when I read these books. I was a little kid, and I remember reading these, and there was so much grisly stuff like this, and, I don't know. I don't know if my parents knew. Well, my parents wouldn't have given a shit. They were pretty neglectful. But if I had normal parents, they probably wouldn't have wanted me reading these books at the age that I did. Not suitable for small children is what most parents would say, I think. But yeah, I remember these things. These things definitely had an impact on me. Like, I didn't really forget them, you know? Like this image right here, I remember it. With the head impaled on the spike and the other heads, and like the thing branded into his forehead. I remember this image. As you reach the far side of the square, you brush against a spike. Fresh blood is smeared across the arm of your tunic, staining it dark red. You raise your eyes, cursing at your misfortune, but you are shocked into silence by the sight before you. Impaled upon the sharp iron pole is the head of the Vasagonian envoy. To either side are the heads of all the galley crew. Oh, the whole crew of my ship got killed. That's horrible. That's basically my fault. On each of their foreheads is freshly branded one word, traitor. Fear wells up inside you. Turning your face away from the sightless eyes, you run into the crowded streets of the Mikarum, the district where the spice and herb merchants live. The spice must flow. Dune reference. At the end of a narrow, winding street, you reach a junction. Opposite is a shop with a bright red sign above the door. Bir Dar Masoon, Herb Mistress. If you need the Oidi herb, which I don't, if you don't need it but want to go in the shop anyway, or if you just want to continue along. I think I need to do a little shopping to take my mind off of the fact that all these people I spent 25 days with learning language from and everything on the ship have all been beheaded and executed basically because of me. That's not cool. Not feeling good about that. Hey, Boss 314, how are you doing? Going in the shop.
You part the bead curtain that hangs across the doorway and enter the cool interior. The light is poor and the room gloomy, for the windows are obscured by sheaves of herbs and plants. You are studying a curious row of colored bottles when a woman appears. She has piercing green eyes and her red hair is raised, bound with rings of jadin. Softly, she speaks to you. It's Boss Pi? Oh, I get it. Right. 3.14. So on and so forth. Pi. Boss Pi. Alright. Nice. Cool name. Hey, Nox Moo. How you doing? Softly she speaks to you.
Welcome, Northlander. I sense you are a warrior, or am I mistaken?
As you hesitate to answer, she shrugs her shoulders and searches through a pile of parchments stacked on top of a wine casket. She blows away the dust before handing you a yellowed sheet. It is a list of merchandise written in Samlending. There's a potion of Alether. Increases combat skill by 2 for the duration of 1 combat, costs 4 gold crowns. There's a potion of Gallowbrush. Induces sleep for 1 to 2 hours per dose, 2 gold crowns. A potion of Lomspur. Restores 4 endurance points per dose for 5 gold crowns. I have one of those. A vial of Larnuma oil. Restores 2 endurance points per dose for 3 gold crowns. A tincture of graveweed causes sickness and loss of 2 endurance points per dose for 1 gold crown. And a tincture of Calicina causes terrifying hallucinations for 1 to 2 hours per dose for 2 gold crowns. Well, I'm tempted to buy some of these poisons with the thought that maybe I'll be able to use them on people, but you know, I don't really see that being Lone Wolf's way, especially like the sickness and the hallucinations ones. It just doesn't really seem very Kai Lord-like to me. But buying a Gallow Brush to maybe put some people to sleep, you know, like slip into their food and put them to sleep, that could turn out to be really useful. So maybe I'll buy one. You may purchase any of the above and in any quantity you desire. All potions, vials, and tinctures are backpack items. You then leave the shop and continue along the street. But I'd have to get rid of something from my backpack to do that. And I don't really want to get rid of any of this stuff. Even the towel. Now that I have a towel that I'm carrying around for no fucking reason, I kind of don't want to get rid of it. I'm kind of attached to this towel. So, I'm just gonna not get any of these things. Continue along the street. All manner of strange and exotic plants, oils, potions, and medicaments fill the shop windows, and the smell of the herb-filled street is intoxicating. There is a sudden bustle of activity at the end of the street. The crowd disperses, melting into the shops as if into thin air. A man stands before you. His face is streaked with sweat, his turquoise robes torn and heavily stained. It is Mauk. He has survived the Bagadaruz.
Were it not for the Zakan, I would kill you here and now, hisses Mauk, his face a mask of hate. But I will not lose my head for a cowardly Samlending.
His insult enrages you, but you control your anger. You sense he is not alone. Eyes are watching you at every window. Well, you know, he's kind of got me there with the cowardly thing. I've pretty much spent this entire book just running away so far. It seems to be alone, right? It's just him? I think it's time to ace this dude. I'm about sick of his BS. So I'm gonna attack him. My voice acting is terrible! It's terrible! It's so bad. Mauk pulls his hand from his robe, a dart held tightly in his sinewy fist. He hisses a curse and flings the missile at your chest. You gasp with shock as the missile strikes home. You were too close to avoid being hit. Well, that's cheating. The dart sinks into your chest. You pull it free, but a wave of nausea makes you fall to your knees.
The tip of the missile is drugged, and you cannot fight the darkness that now engulfs your vision. Oh shit, did I just lose? Or did I just get captured? That's not really very fair. Here we go. Well, I'm not dead. You wake up in great discomfort. Every muscle of your body feels knotted and bruised. You force open eyelids clogged with dried sweat and look with dread at your wretched surroundings. You are lying on the hard stone floor of a prison cell. Over by the far wall, beneath a window crisscrossed with iron bars, is a low wooden bunk covered in filthy rags. Cockroaches, some the size of field mice, scuttle along a foul-smelling gutter that disappears into a grating in the floor. Erase from your action chart all weapons, special items, gold crowns, and your backpack. This has happened to me before, and it was not good. I never got my stuff back. And your backpack and all its contents, but note them down elsewhere in case you should find them again later. Okay, so it sounds to me like I have a real chance of finding my stuff again here. So I'm not going to erase anything. I'm just going to keep in mind right now that I don't have any of this stuff. And we'll see what happens. You discover that your hands are free and slowly pull yourself upright into a sitting position, resting your back against the cell door. A faint draft from the corridor outside provides the only relief from the stifling heat and bad air of the cell. In the distance, you can hear footsteps approaching. Then there is a jangle of keys and the creak of hinges. A door closes with a dull thud. More footsteps. They are getting louder. They come to halt outside the cell door and a loud voice bellows out, "Sleeping on duty, Sefru! You'll wake up on the other side of this door if the captain catches you!" The chair scrapes along the ground, and a startled voice, full of indignation, replies, "Curse you, Hadj! The Zakan doesn't want the Northlander taken to the Grand Hall till sunset! You've cheated me of 2 hours sleep!" "Shut up, Sefrau!" snarls the first voice, "and listen hard! I've just come from the armory. Some interesting trinkets were found on the Northlander, worth a great deal of gold, I'd say. Seems a pity to let them go to waste, eh?" The two guards chuckle greedily and discuss at length the good time they will have in the city once they have sold your equipment. Motherfuckers, do not sell my shit. My shit is mine. I want it back. "I'll take a peek at our friend," says one of the guards. "I wonder if he's enjoying our hospitality." A spy hole slides open above your head and you hear a gasp of shock. "He's gone! He's gone! By the Mahan, we'll lose our heads!" You suddenly realize that you cannot be seen so close to the door. "Let me see," hisses the other guard, eager to see for himself. You hear the click of a key in the lock. This could be your chance to escape. "I'm attacking as soon as the door opens. Fuck these guards. I don't have any weapons, though, so I'm gonna kind of get punked. I don't have my... I mean, I got nothing. All this plus 10 right here is gone, because I don't have my shield or my Sombra Sword, and I'm gonna get a penalty to combat skill, because I don't have a weapon. But at least I still have Mind Blast." The guards pull open the door, and you spring into action. Your clenched fist strikes the first man beneath his bearded jaw, lifting him from the floor with the power of the blow. His sword drops from his hand and clatters to the ground close to your feet. Yes, a sword. I will pick up the sword. You stoop to grasp the sword, but as your fingers close around the hilt, the second guard attacks. Alright, so I have to fight the palace gaoler here. Which is not a problem. At least I have a sword. So, I temporarily do not have any of that plus 10 right there. So I'm down to base 15 combat skill. I don't get a penalty though because I have a weapon. I still have Mind Blast though, so I get to benefit from that. Ignore all endurance points lost by the enemy in the first round of combat, for you can only attempt to parry his blow. Alright, so in the first round, I don't get to do any damage to him. Alright, so 28-20, round 1. I lost 1, he lost 10, but he didn't really lose 10 because I had to ignore that. Alright, round 2. 27-21. Alright, that time he lost 10, and I lost 1. So I'm still kicking this guy's ass, but round 3. I lost none, and he died. Parried his blow, cut him deep, ran him through. It's over. Thanks for playing, Random Palace Galer. Alright, I won, and the fight lasted less than four rounds or less, so hopefully there's no reinforcements running to kick my ass right now. I'm starting healing myself. The guard clutches at his wounds and drops lifeless to the ground. You see that the other man is recovering from your blow and is clawing at the cell door to try to pull himself to his feet. I'm gonna overpower him and capture him alive so that hopefully he can tell me where my stuff is. You grasp the frightened guard in a secure headlock and threaten to break his neck if he does not answer your questions. He immediately promises to tell you everything he knows. This guy's a real soldier, I guess, huh? Unbreakable, this guy. He says that the new Zakan fears that you are an assassin sent by his enemies in the West. He claims to hate the new Zakan himself. He is only a simple Galer, he says, and knows nothing more. Alright, I'll use my Discipline of Sixth Sense, which I do have. The man is lying. He knows that other guards are sure to turn up at any moment. As soon as you loosen your grip, he will attempt to overpower you and raise the alarm. I'm gonna keep questioning him. The guard begins to cough. He pleads with you to slacken your grip or he will choke to death. You ask him one more question. Does he know where your confiscated equipment is? He says he does not know. Fucking liar! Tell me where it is! Then, suddenly, he elbows you in the chest and breaks free. You are winded, but you are determined to stop him from escaping. Your attack is swift and deadly. Before the guard can scream for help, you have silenced him for good with an open-handed chop to the neck. Judo chop! Alright, leave the bodies, search the bodies. Obviously, we're going to search the bodies, cut the games. A thorough search of both bodies uncovers the following items. A sword, a dagger, a warhammer, 6 gold crowns. So, I've got a sword that I took from them. The Galer's keys. I'll mark those down here, separate from my stuff that I currently don't have. And my crowns are gone. But I just found 6, so I'm just gonna put... Oh. I'm gonna put 6 gold crowns right there. Leave that alone for the moment. I'm hoping I can find my stuff. I got the keys. Needs more Vulcan death grip. I know, right? You may take any of the above items. Remember to mark them on your action chart. The Galer's keys should be worn attached to your belt. You remember to lock the cell door before you hurry off along the corridor. But they took my belt. The corridor heads north, but soon ends at a junction where another passage runs across from east to west. Cautiously, you peer around the corner, but there are no signs of any guards. At the end of the east passage, you can see a flight of steps descending out of view. To the west, you see a closed door. Door sounds good. Door sounds like a room, and a room sounds like a place where my stuff could be. The heavy wooden door is reinforced with bands of black iron, held in place by huge bronze studs. You turn the handle, only to find the door is locked. I do have the keys. Once you have unlocked the door, you twist the handle and open it a few inches. You see a stair descending to a small chamber where a black-robed soldier is guarding a pair of iron gates. Through the bars, you can see rows of weapons and suits of armor stacked in long racks. A sign fixed to the bars says, Grand Palace Armory. Alright, my stuff could be in there. I'm gonna use camouflage here, be super sneaky. Using your Kai skill to disguise your Somlending accent, you call out to the guard. Quick! We need your help! The Northlander is escaping! Immediately, the guard leaps to his feet and charges up the stairs toward the door. You wait until he reaches the top step before you attack. One kick to the knee sends him tumbling backwards into the chamber, where he falls in a heap at the foot of the stairs. You enter the chamber, poised to strike again should the guard recover and attack. However, this time your caution is unnecessary. The guard is dead. His neck was broken in the fall. I just broke a dude's neck by kicking him in the knee. That's some fucking Bruce Lee shit right there. Search his body. Of course I'm gonna search his body. You turn the body over with the toe of your boot and search the robes, discovering the following items. 4 gold crowns, Galo's keys, dagger, and sword. So, let's take those other 4 crowns in case I don't get mine back. I've already got the keys. Alright, let's keep going. The iron gates of the armory are unlocked. You push open the left gate and wince as the shrill squeak of a dry hinge sends a shiver down your spine. Oh, I can just imagine that noise. It's not a good noise. Shield with a very large spike on it. And a spear. Inside, at the end of a long aisle, is a workbench littered with spearheads, sword hilts, and all manner of armorer's tools. In the midst of this tangled mass is a large, black, leather-bound book. Open the book or ignore the book. I'll open the book. Never ignore anything. It is an armory log. The pages contain handwritten lists of all the work carried out here. Spears and swords made for the garrison of Caracalla, ore shipments from the Vakar Mountains, weapons due for repair, and all manner of daily routines are carefully recorded. Well, that doesn't sound very interesting. You are about to discard the log when you notice a folded piece of parchment tucked into the spine. It is a list of dates and numbers with a heading in bold print, The Bronze Door. You scan the page and locate today's date. The number listed next to it is 67. Something just happened to my background music. Hold 'em up. What's going on here, background music? Alright. This is a little playlist I made of all Kevin MacLeod songs. Just to play in the background while I do this. Boss Pie says, how are you playing / reading this? There's a website called Project Aeon that has reprinted in digital form like this all of the Lone Wolf books. And they created this, somebody there created this program called Stats Keeper that's in the browser that keeps track of all your stuff and automates the battle rounds so you don't have to like, and I can roll random numbers, see between 0 and 9, which the game asks you to do on a regular basis. So it's through the Project Aeon website. All the books are on there for free. That was done with the author's permission, which is pretty cool. Joe Deaver, he wrote all the books. These books were written way back in the 80s when I was a kid, and I read them. I owned them back then, but now I'm revisiting them as like a nostalgia thing, I guess. Number listed next to it is 67. Make a note of this number in the margin of your action chart. It could be of use at a later stage in your adventure. Alright, I'll write that down. 67. You know, if you're gonna have a secret code to your door that changes every day, and you're gonna write all the codes down, do not label it with a big thing that says the Bronze Door. Like, I think you could just not put that label on there. People that needed to know would already know what the numbers meant. And people like me that have broken into your place wouldn't necessarily figure it out so easy. You throw the book back onto the cluttered bench and begin to search for your missing equipment. Yes, give me my missing equipment. The last time I got all my equipment taken from me, I didn't ever find it again, which was bad. I lost everything. But this time it'll be way, way worse because I have the Sommer Sword, which is this amazing magical sword that's just godlike. And if I lose that, I'm going to be really unhappy. This is the 5th book in the series, just so you know. I've done the same thing with streaming with the first 4 books, and this is the 5th one. There's like 28 of them. There's so many. You root through all the drawers and cupboards of the workbench, smashing locks when they refuse to open, only to be disappointed. These drawers and cupboards do not contain your missing equipment. Fuck. All hope of signing a peace treaty with the new Zakan has vanished. Your only concern now is to find your equipment, escape from the Grand Palace, and somehow return home to Summerland as quickly as possible. You pull aside a latticed partition and enter a small antechamber. Narrow stone steps lead up to an open door in the north wall, beside which stands a wooden chest. I had viewers a couple times before. Like one viewer a couple times. I don't know. At least people that chatted in chat. I don't know if other people have come and viewed and not said anything in chat. I'm going to investigate this wooden chest. The chest is plain except for a small square of red metal bolted to the top. There is no lock, but instinctively you avoid opening the lid with your hands in case it is booby-trapped. Nearby, you notice a wooden bucket and a ladle. Using the ladle, you lever open the chest and push back the lid. The chest itself is not booby-trapped, but your caution was well-placed. Coiled on a bed of jewel-encrusted maces lies a yaz, a non-poisonous but very large Vasagonian snake. A red-forked tongue flicks out of its yellow head as it prepares to defend its valuable bed. I'll fight it. I've got a sword. The yaz is a constrictor. It kills its prey by crushing them to death with the coils of its powerful body. Its sleepy eyes have now opened, and the red-rimmed slit pupils fix you with a mesmerizing stare. You suddenly realize that the yaz is trying to hypnotize you. Unless you have the Kai Discipline of Mind Shield, deduct 3 points from your combat skill for the duration of this combat. Well, as it turns out, Mr. Snake, I do have Mind Shield, so suck it. And I also have Mind Blast, so you're going to take some of that, too. Alright, I have no doubt that I will easily defeat this thing. It only has 14 combat skill. Whereas I have 17 with Mind Blast. Alright, here we go. Round 1. I lost none, it lost 16. How do you like that, Yaz? Stick that in your Yaz. 28-12. I lost none again! I'm rolling good. I mean, I have an advantage on combat skill, so that really helps on the chart. But, I'm rolling really good too. It's almost dead. And it didn't even hurt me at all. I just killed it in 3 rounds with taking no damage. Just chopped up a snake. Really no big deal. A psychic snake. The great snake shudders and convulses in the throes of death. The smell of its thick brown blood is disgusting, and you have to hold your breath and grit your teeth as you lift the dead yaz away from the chest and peer inside. You discover 6 silver-handled maces, each beautifully carved and encrusted with rubies, emeralds, and pearls. In the Northlands, these weapons would fetch thousands of crowns. At the bottom of the chest, you also discover a small copper key. If you wish to take either a jeweled mace or the copper key, or both, mark them on your action chart as special items. Carry the copper key in the pocket of your tunic and the jeweled mace tucked into your belt. All right. I'll take a copper key. I'll take this jeweled mace. I mean, the funny thing is, in these books there's very specific rules on how many items you can have and so forth. And there's even a rule, you're only allowed to carry 50 gold crowns with you. You can only ever have 50 gold. So even if I sold this thing for thousands of crowns, I'd be like, listen, I'll just give me 50. Just give me 50, you can go ahead and keep the rest there. It'd be pretty funny. Think about it. Alright, the acidic smell of the snake blood is beginning to make you retch. Quickly, you climb the stone steps and leave the armory by the north door. Still haven't found my stuff, which is concerning. I just found my stuff. You step into a perfect hemisphere. The walls of the chamber curve smoothly into the ceiling, where a small window casts a splash of light across the floor. There is a large circular dais in the center of the room, laden with incense burners, decanters, quilts, scrolls, cloaks, urns, and all kinds of fruit and sweetmeats. I could eat. A drawer catches your eye. Protruding from beneath the lip of the dais, you recognize the contents. You have found your confiscated equipment. Yes! Restore to your action chart all the backpack items, special items, weapons, and gold crowns you lost when you were imprisoned. Elated by your discovery, I really am, you resolve to escape from the Grand Palace as quickly as possible. Now that I got my stuff back, I just kind of want to go through the palace killing all these fuckers. There is only one other door, apart from the one by which you entered the chamber, which is set into the north wall. Alright, so let's figure out... So, I'm going to take two of those combined with the 48 I had, I'm now maxed back out at 60. I get all this stuff back. I get all this stuff back and have these two items as well. Yeah, I'm sad. And I sacrificed the spear that I was carrying. You're only allowed to carry two weapons. Except my Summer Sword is also a weapon, but it counts as a special item for whatever reason. So, take that Jeweled Mace. So I'm all set. I actually have everything. We're all done with messing about. Oh, and I get to add 10 back to this from my shield and my magic sword. So I'm ready to really kick some ass now. Okay. Leave the chamber, search the chamber for useful items. Well, of course we're going to search the chamber. I mean, this isn't my first rodeo. You sift through the vast number of items that litter the dais, separating the following articles, which may or may not be of use. A silver comb, an hourglass, a dagger, a healing potion of Lamspur, a prism, enough food for three meals. Well, okay. A prism sounds useful. Maybe an hourglass, too. I'm gonna get rid of this bluestone triangle that I found in Caverns of Cult, because I think it was book specific and I'm never gonna need to use it again. I can't eat some of this food right now, unfortunately. You don't get to decide when you eat, the book just tells you when you have to use a meal, and then if you don't have one, you lose endurance. But generally, it's not a big deal for me because I have the healing skill, so I get to keep healing myself up as I go. Plus, I have hunting, so in a lot of places, I don't have to have a meal either because I can feed myself with hunting, but not here in the desert, as it turns out. I'm gonna take a prism. I think I'll leave the rest of this crap here. Just because I don't have room for it in my... I can't get rid of my towel! I mean, you never know when you're gonna need a towel. Douglas Adams has taught us that. Alright, leaving the chamber. You follow a straight passage of pale rose-colored stone, which soon ends at an empty vestibule. In its north wall is set a great wooden door, covered with engraved bronze plaques and studded with bronze nails. There is a curious lock set into the middle of this door, encircled by a beautiful carving of a long-tailed scorpion. A closer look at the lock reveals a series of Vasagonian numerals, numbered 1 to 200, engraved in the lock. You recognize the design. It is a Cloasian combination lock. I do know the correct number. It's 67, right? 67. It says, the section corresponding to the correct answer will have a footnote confirming that it is indeed correct. If you choose the wrong section and go to 98, you don't get a second guess. Yeah, you might find Ford Prefect. Exactly, so you're familiar with Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. Man, those are some good books. Okay, so I turn to 67. And footnote says this is the correct answer. Nice. You hear a faint click, followed by a soft whirring sound. The bronze door slides open. As you hurry through, the door clicks shut behind your back as softly as it had opened. Instinct tells you that you have entered the chambers of the upper palace, the sumptuous private enclave of the Zakan. You walk upon glistening tiles of opal and platinum, past sculptures and statues of pure gold. The door of solid amethyst ahead seems plain. A door of solid amethyst? What? How do you get an amethyst big enough to make a door out of? That's ridiculous. Seems plain in comparison to the breathtaking splendor of this private world. Beyond the door lies another unique and startlingly beautiful world, the Arboretum. A circular cathedral-like arena spreads out below you, the green velvet canopy alive with the sound of bird song. Trees of every color. Right? How would that move? I know, you know how much that door would fucking weigh? I mean, unless that amethyst is sliced really thin. Trees of every color, shape, and size flourish in the deep, dark soil of the floor. The Zakan's Arboretum houses a specimen of every tree that grows in Magnamund, and many species that are now extinct elsewhere. As you walk the wrought iron balcony which encircles the Arboretum, you recognize the leaves of a Somlending oak. You feel a sudden wave of homesickness, but it does not make you despair. Rather, it renews your determination to escape from this hostile, sun-bleached land. So, massive opulence. Apparently this guy's got more wealth than fucking anybody. At one of the exits from the Arboretum, you discover a quarterstaff propped against the wall. I'm good. The desire to escape urges you on as you leave the Arboretum and hurry through a network of lavish corridors and empty, deserted vestibules. You reach a landing where a broad staircase descends to a massive room that occupies most of the lower palace. From the top of the staircase, hidden by the shadow of a pilaster, you stare down on a sight that freezes your blood with terror. Alright. My blood is frozen for terror. With terror, that sounds like a good time to take a drink of water. Wonder if the player was actually mesmerized by the snake and is seeing this landscape. I know, right? This I could just be like hallucinating all of this because of the snake's hypnotism or something. All right, turn to 200. This feels very epic. Here we go. Upon a raised platform, carpeted with scarlet fur, sits the Vasagonian Emperor Zakan Kima. He is robed in gold, but devoid of all ornamentation. In his hand is an orb of black metal, and in his eye, an ice-cold cruelty that chills your spine. The Zakan is a man of awesome countenance, but he pales in the shadow of his companion. Before him stands the cause of your terror. A helm as black as death itself hides the face, but the stench of decay and a hideous sepulchral voice betrayed the identity.
Give me, Lone Wolf!
It is the fell voice of a mortal enemy, a Dark Lord of Helgadad. As the Zakan rises to his feet, you notice a flicker of doubt, or perhaps of fear, dim his cruel gaze, but he is quick to mask it.
He will be brought to you at sunset in exchange for the Orb of Death. It is agreed.
You have the orb,
echoes the chilling voice.
Give me, Lone Wolf!
The Zakan hides his fear well, but time is not on his side. The game of bluff he is playing is deadly. However, the fact that he has not yet been discovered is evidence of his powerful will. For you sense the Dark Lord is persistently clawing and probing at his mind.
You will get your Northlander, Lord Hakan, says the Zakan, his voice curt with anger, when you tell me why your servants defile the tomb of the Mahan. You claim to have no need for gold and jewels. Why then do you plunder the graves of our ancestors?
A deathly quiet fills the hall. Only the unnatural hiss of the Dark Lord's breath disturbs the silence.
This land, this insignificant speck of sand, harbors two small thorns that prick our skin. We seek to remove them both forever. The fledgling Kai, Lone Wolf, is the thorn that denies us Summerland. The tomb of the Mahan hides the other thorn that threatens us. The accursed Book of the Magna Kai.
Your heart pounds as the words echo in your head. The Book of the Magna Kai. Suddenly, the reason why you have been enticed into a deadly trap becomes clear, and the sinister truth is revealed. The Book of the Magna Kai is one of the oldest legends of Summerland. With the wisdom of the Magna Kai, Sun Eagle, the first Kai Grand Master, instilled the disciplines into the warriors of the House of Ulnar, the bloodline of your king, that were to save your land from devastation at the hands of the Dark Lords. The Book of the Magna Kai was lost hundreds of years ago, but its wisdom was kept alive, handed down through generations of Somlending warriors, so that they could share the strength to resist their eternal enemies, the Dark Lords of Helgadad. If the Dark Lords discover and destroy the Book of the Magna Kai, the secrets will be lost forever, and when you die, the Kai will become extinct. Because I'm the last one. Because the rest of them were all killed in the beginning of Book 1. However, if you discover the Book of the Magna Kai first and deny the Dark Lords their prize, all the wisdom of the Magna Kai will be revealed to you. Through its wisdom, you will become strong, strong enough to reach the ultimate achievement for a Somlending warrior, to become a Kai Grand Master. And then there'll be more books. However, the peril and the glory of the quest that lies ahead are distracting you from more immediate danger. To discover this danger and to begin the quest for the Book of the Magna Kai, turn to Part 2 of Shadow on the Sand. And we've now completed the first of the, what they're calling, two adventures in this book. Normally, like I said in the beginning, normally these books, each adventure has 350 sections. This one is two adventures of 200 sections each. So this right here was section 200. So this is the end of Part 1 of the book and the beginning of Part 2. Dark Lord is kind of a big deal. Like, I don't really think I can fight one of those. They're like Sauron or something. I mean, they're like the main big enemies of the entire world. So I too am cowering in fear. Begin my adventure at page 201. Suddenly you catch sight of two warriors creeping towards you from a passage to your right. They are clad in jet black armor, and that's gotta suck in the desert where these guys live, just saying. And scarlet robes, and their hideous death masks identify them as Drakkarim warriors. They are men, but they are evil men, as evil as the Dark Lords whom they serve. One of them holds a razor-fanged Akataz, a creeping, leathery war dog, straining on a chain leash. The Drakkar hisses, and the Akataz springs towards your throat. You know, I like dogs, but I don't like them leathery. Like, when I think of adjectives that I like applied to dogs, leathery is not one of the ones I like. Generally, if a dog is leathery, you know that dog is going to be a problem. Do I want to fight it or try to escape? Fuck that. Akataz must die. The Akataz leaps through the air at your face. You fall backwards, kicking with both feet, but you are winded as the war dog jolts the air from your lungs. It slashes your shoulder. Lose one endurance point. Fine. Before cartwheeling over the edge of the stairs, its howl cut short as it smashes into the marble floor of the lower palace. Well, that thing was pretty easy to take care of. You spring to your feet and draw your weapon, for the Drakkarim are running towards you. A terrible roar of hate and rage fills the hall.
Kill him!
The Drakkarim unsheathe their black swords, eager to obey their master's command. They attack you simultaneously. Alright, so fight a couple Drakkarim. They have a lot of endurance, but I'm gonna punk them, really. They don't really stand a chance. Now that I have the Somerous Word back, that huge combat skill advantage on my side will make this pretty easy work, I think. Alright. Was that kind of loud? I'm sorry. My bad. Alright, let's go for round one here. I lost none. They lost 16. Yeah, these guys aren't making it. I lost none, they lost 18. So far they haven't hurt me at all, and they're about to die. Oh, they hurt me that time. They took 4 off my endurance that time. With their last one, just clinging barely to life, the last guy managed to cut me. So I win, though, which is good. I didn't even turn my Mind Blast on for that fight. If I win the combat, yeah, I did. I did win the combat, thanks. You glimpse the silhouette of Dark Lord Hakan in the hall below, his spiked fist raised. Of course his fist is going to be spiked. There is a deafening crack as a bolt of blue lightning streaks from a stone in the Dark Lord's hand and hurtles towards you. You dive for cover behind the body of the Drakkar as the bolt explodes. In a flash of light, the Drakkar is gone. Only cinders and the rotten odor of scorched flesh remain. So I'm glad that didn't hit me. You scramble to your feet and sprint along the passage. Another bolt hurtles from the hall, tearing into the ceiling with shattering effect. Splinters of razor-sharp marble whistle down, slashing your cloak and tunic. You race down some stairs, through a silver archway and along a balcony that overlooks the lower palace. A peal of bells and the crunch of iron-shod boots echo in your ears. The Zakan has sounded the alarm. His guards close in on every side. So now we're back to this, with me running away from shitloads of desert ninjas coming after me. At the end of the balcony are another arch and a staircase. Both look deserted. I'm gonna race up the stairs, I guess. The blood is pounding in your ears as you bound up the marble steps. 20 feet ahead of you, there is a landing with a stone door set into the wall. The stairs continue to ascend to a parapeted walkway, at the end of which is another stone door, identical to the first. Suddenly, the door on the first landing swings open and a palace guard wheels round to face you. Mahan! He cries, fumbling for the hilt of his sword. It feels a little unsporting to just ace this dude while he's trying to draw his weapon. On the other hand, he's just gonna chase me if I don't. I think he needs to die. Using your skill for unarmed combat taught to you by your Kai masters, you grab the startled guard by the throat and pitch him over the low wall at the edge of the landing. His cry of terror fills the air until he crashes into the flagstones below. Insert Wilhelm scream here. Continue climbing the stairs toward the door of the walkway, or enter the door through which the guard came. Continue climbing the stairs. I feel like going up is the way forward here. Can run along the rooftops or something. A crossbow bolt grazes your shoulder as you reach the walkway. Oh, I just forgot something, by the way. Hold on. There was the fight. 1, 2, 3, 4. I get 4 health back. But then I lose an endurance point here, so I go back down to 26. A crossbow bolt grazes your shoulder as you reach the walkway, making you dive for cover behind its low parapet wall. You lose 1 endurance point. 2 more bolts ricochet from the stone lip, barely inches from your head. The stone door is shut, secured by an iron bolt on this side. To pull open the bolt, you will have to expose yourself to crossbow fire, for the bolt is clearly in view above the lip of the wall. Except, I have the Kai Discipline of Mind Over Matter. Yes, I do. So, let's use that to open the bolt without leaving cover. Nice. You stare at the bolt, willing it to move. The sound of running footsteps behind you sends a cold shiver down your spine as you realize that the Drakkarim are storming the stairs.
Then, slowly, the bolt begins to move. As soon as it clears the bolt hole, you pull open the stone portal and race through, unaware of what lies beyond. Did you just link to a thing of the Wilhelm scream? Beyond the portal lies a vaulted corridor leading to a grand stairway. Oh, I get to heal some more. You narrowly avoid confrontation with a dozen Drakkarim, saved by your lightning reactions. As the enemy rush from an archway on the second floor landing, you dive behind a statue of the recently deceased Zakan Mudala. They are so intent on their chase that they fail to notice your hiding place and hurry down the stairs, grunting in their heavy armor as they run. Silently, you give thanks that Zakan Mudala was a very stout man and that his statue casts a very large shadow in which to hide. At the top of the stairway, you discover a hatch, which gives access to the roof. You climb through it and follow a path of sun-bleached tiles that wind in and out of the domes and turrets, eventually leading to a bell tower. See, now I am running on the roof. That's good. You are exhausted and need to rest, your mind still full of the shock of your encounter with Dark Lord Hakan. The sound of his terrible voice repeating the words, Book of the Magna Chi, echoes again and again in your mind. With desperation sapping your will, you peer out through a grill in the bell tower. The sight before you renews your flagging hope, for it inspires a daring escape plan. Oh boy, here we go with daring plans. Below the bell tower, you see a line of Itakar pens, each with its own circular landing platform. Itakar are a breed of huge black birds that nest in eyries high in the peaks of the Dahir and Vakar mountains. The Vasagonians have long since tamed the giants of these skies, using them as winged mounts for their army leaders, their scouts, couriers, and envoys. An Itakar and rider swoop down out of the reddening sky and alight upon the platform nearest to the bell tower. Slaves hurl a rope to the rider, who in turn fixes it to a saddle ring before he jumps to the ground. The Itakar caws and beats its huge wings as it is slowly winched into the pen by a hidden capstan. The rider and the slaves leave the platform. There is now only one sentry on guard at the pen. If you can overpower him, you can make your escape on the back of the giant bird. Escaping on the back of a giant bird, huh? I feel like we're approaching the cover art. The moment in the book when you get to the cover art is always like, it's the best. We're approaching the time of the cover art, I think. Does the escape plan involve a towel and a transporter? Unfortunately, no. Unfortunately, no. Get Ford Prefect to help me get out of here. I do not possess a blowpipe and sleep dart. I don't even know where I would get such a thing, but I don't have one. So, let's see what... Can I just run up and hack this dude down with my sword? I mean, like, that seems to work for everybody else. You leave the bell tower and make your way down towards the sentry. At first, dodging from one turret to the next, it is easy to remain unseen. However, for the final 30 yards to the landing platform, you will have no cover, for the platform and the palace roof are linked by an exposed gangplank. If you are to overpower the sentry, you must cross the gangplank undetected. Well, I have camouflage. Oh, mind over matter. Am I going to use that again? Or I can do a random number, which never ends well. Basically, you roll something bad and instantly die. So I'll use mind over matter. Telekinesis some shit. Yes, telekinesis is totally a legit verb. Focusing your skill on a money pouch that hangs from the sentry's belt, you concentrate on untying the leather thong that secures it. Oh, that's clever. Seconds later, the pouch drops to the ground and spills its contents. The guard yelps in horror as he sees his gold rolling over the edge of the platform and drops to his knees to gather what little remains. As he turns his back, you break cover and run across the gangplank. Your speed and stealth carry you across the gangplank undetected. When you strike, the guard is still on his knees, picking up his scattered gold. Your attack is silent and deadly.
Obviously, I'm going to search his body. You discover little of interest. 8 gold crowns and a brass whistle on a chain around the guard's neck. You may take these if you wish, but remember to mark them on your action chart. Brass whistle. That sounds like it could come in handy. I don't think I'm going to need the healer's keys anymore. Suddenly, a noise alerts you to unwelcome company. Drakarim are rushing along the tiled pathway that leads to the pens. Without a moment's hesitation, you turn and run inside the Itakar's enclosure. And I'm maxed out on crowns. You're only allowed to carry 50, so I can't take this gold he's got. The great black bird beats its massive wings, cawing hoarsely through the domed pen. 2 black eyes, fierce and cold, fix you with a deadly stare as you edge nearer to its perch. Grabbing the saddle pommel, you haul yourself up, but suddenly there is a flash of razor-sharp talons. Instinctively, you shield your face as a glint of orange sunlight is caught on the Itakar's curved beak, for it slashes the air barely inches above your head. I have animal kinship. I don't have an onyx medallion. And I'm not going to go do a random roll. Random rolls always screw you, basically. But I'm going to use animal kinship, because, you know, I can. It can take many years for a rider to tame an Itakar, for by nature they are wild and malicious creatures. You use your Kai skill to communicate with the giant bird, to assure it that you mean no harm. It fixes you with a cold, black stare, but you sense that it is no longer hostile. As you settle in its wide saddle, you catch sight of the Drakarim as they stream across the gangplank. Quickly, you lean forward, unhook the anchor rope from the saddle ring, and grab the thick leather reins. It's time to fly! Fly up out of here. You are jerked backwards in the saddle as the Itakar leaves its perch. It shrieks and caws, its wings beating as loud as thunder. A handful of Drakarim are scattered as if they were rag dolls as the great black bird emerges from the pen and takes to the sky. You catch a glimpse of a Drakar, his death mask slashed in two by the bird's razor-sharp talons as he pitches from the landing platform and tumbles to his death in the palace gardens far below. There he is, falling. His mask has been ripped open. He looks really unamused. This guy is like, fuck this. This guy's like, fuck my life. As he falls, he doesn't even bother to Wilhelm scream. He just falls in silence. The golden domes of the Grand Palace grow smaller as the Itakar gathers speed. Soon, you have passed over the city wall and are heading out toward the shimmering salt flats of Lake Inrahim. The land below is bathed in beautiful orange twilight as the sun slowly sinks behind the Dahir Mountains to the west. Elated by your escape, you throw back your head and give voice to a triumphant yell that is carried away on the chill evening wind. As if in answer to your cry, an echoing chorus of shrieks pierce the sky. Fear returns to your heart as you catch sight of a flock of Kron, hideous leathery-winged flyers. I've fought Kron before. Each carries a Drakarim warrior on its back. They are over a mile behind you, but they are quickly closing the gap. Less than an hour of light remains. If you can evade them a little longer, you may be able to lose them when night falls. You must decide in which direction to fly, for you are now above the center of Lake Inrahim. Consult the map before making your decision. So I can go south towards Dahir Pass or east towards Chula. Alright, let's take a look at the map here. So I'm over here, over the lake. I can go south towards the Dahir Pass or east towards Chula. Where am I trying to get to? I don't remember where they said I was actually, where the thing actually is. Yeah, sorry, part of the map is blocked by the book cover thing that I've put up there, but I can't scroll over anymore, but this is almost all of the map. Each book has a different map. It's pretty cool. There was the Frozen Icelands of Kalt in book 3 that had its own map. And the books 1 and 4 were in the more temperate lands to the northwest of here. Like up here, just from that direction is where the other places were that we were, where the map was. All right, so I feel like flying south toward the pass is better than flying over to that village, I guess. So I'm going to steer the Itakar south toward the Dahir Pass. Decides to sail toward the secret cow level? Yeah, exactly. Moo, 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 moo. Yeah. Alright, Dahir Pass it is. A terrible shriek rings out above the rush of the wind, filling your head with pain. You are being attacked by a powerful mind blast. Unless you possess the Kai discipline of Mind Shield, deduct 2 endurance points from your current total. Of course, I have Mind Shield. Got the games. I got that one in the last book. You start off in book 1 and you only have 5 of these 10 abilities. But each book that you complete, you get another one. And I've done all of them up to this point, so that's why I have 9 out of 10. Because this is the 5th book. Whereas if you just started with this book and you didn't do the books before it, you would only have 5 abilities. Of course, why you would pick up something that clearly says book 5 on the cover and start with that instead of trying to get the first book, I don't really know, but... The Itakar shudders and frantically twists its head from side to side as the shriek rings out again. You sense that the great bird is in agony, racked by the mind blast. As you glance over your shoulder, your stomach becomes knotted with fear. A Kron is swooping down to attack. On its back is your adversary, a Vordak, one of the undead and a hideous lieutenant of the Dark Lords. I fought one of those before. I thought this was a Hellghast. Based on the cover, but it's not. It's a Vordak. As the Kron streaks towards you, the Vordak spreads its red-robed arms and leaps from the saddle. It lands behind you, astride the Itakar's back, its skeletal fingers sunk deep into your mount's feathered flesh. The shock of the impact throws you forward and the reins slip from your hands. The giant bird screeches in horror and pain as the Vordak's grip paralyzes its spine. You must act quickly, for the Itakar is now plummeting toward the salt plain of Lake Inrahim. This is a picture of the Vordak. What's up, Skeletor? How you doing? He looks weird with having eyeballs inside his skull face. Getting on my bird. Guess what this means, folks? We have reached the cover art. That is where we are right now. And that awesome, like, flaming, blazing sword he has on the cover is the Sommer Sword, which of course I have, because I completed book 2 and got it. As you unsheathe the Sommer Sword, a vivid golden flame shoots along the blade. Cover art. The Vordak shrieks in terror, its blood-drenched bony fingers clawing at a black iron mace that hangs from its belt. It raises the mace to parry your blow, but the Sun Sword shears through the iron, a splash of blue flame erupting in its wake. Cover art. You strike again, curving the golden blade in a great arc. It bites into the Vordak's neck, tearing through its unnatural body and severing it diagonally from collarbone to hip. A sickening acidic smell chokes your throat as a fountain of green slime erupts from beneath the red robe. The Vordak crumples and topples from view, its dissolving corpse hissing as it spirals towards Lake Inrahim. It didn't even make me fight. I just insta-won. You probably insta-lose if you don't have the Samur's Sword. Sheathing your sword, you grab the reins and fight to control your injured mount. You have slain the Vordak, but the battle is not yet won. The Itakar is losing a lot of blood. It could become unconscious at any moment and drop like a stone. That's not good. Suddenly, you spot something in the distance. It is a sight that renews your faith in miracles. Oh, what's it gonna be? Emerging from a bank of cloud on the skyline is a flying ship. Okay, I was not expecting that. It is a small craft, no bigger than an Unaram river barge, with two triangular sails swept back either side of its curving prow. In the fading twilight, you can make out a long pennant that flutters from its mast. A faint humming reaches your ears. Your first reaction is disbelief. What you are seeing must be a trick of the light or some fiendish illusion created by the Dark Lords. However, as the ship floats nearer, your senses tell you that it is indeed quite real. I have ever been given a Crystal Star Pendant. That was when I met Baindon, the Wizard of Torin, in the very first book. He gave me that. And then I lost it when I got robbed and all my stuff taken away in Ragadorn in the second book. But basically, it's asking if you've ever met Baindon. Which, I did. I was given one, so let's see what happens. Standing in a fortified platform in the center of the strange craft is a blonde-haired young man with deep, brooding eyes. Instantly, you recognize him. It is Baindon, the young Somlending magician who gave you the Crystal Star Pendant at the ruins of Raumas after you saved his life in a Giyak ambush. You were so stunned by his unexpected appearance that you failed to notice the blood seeping from the Itakar's mouth. The creature is near to death. Suddenly, the great bird lets out a pitiful and agonized call. Its wings stiffen, and its head falls limp as the last flicker of life escapes from its torn body. It pushes you forward, and your stomach heaves as you plummet towards Lake Inrahim. Pick a random number time, huh? I can tell you right now, looking at these numbers, that if you get a 9, you instantly die. That's the instant death number right there. Let's see what I got. A 7. Alright, so we go to this one. The chill air whips past your face as you tumble towards Lake Inrahim. The Kron Riders, the skyship, and the distant horizon all melt into a kaleidoscope of shapes and images. You fear these will be the last things you will ever see. You have prepared yourself for death and feel calm and relaxed. Suddenly, you feel your body engulfed by a mass of sticky fibers. There is a terrific jolt, which leaves you breathless and stunned. Lose 2 endurance points. Okay. The impossible is happening. You are no longer falling, but rising. Oh, I think he caught... Oh, I've been caught in a net. You've been caught by a net of sticky strands like a fly in a web. You rise into the sky towards the flying ship as quickly as you fell. 3 bearded dwarves clad in bright padded battle jerkins pull you aboard an outrigger that runs the length of the hull. There's no time to express your gratitude, for the small skyship is under attack from the Kron Riders. At the end of the outrigger, a dwarf is in hand-to-hand combat with a snarling Drakkar. He is losing the battle. As you rush to help him, another of the evil warriors lands in the center of the craft, on top of the fortified platform. We can help the dwarf, or leap from the outrigger onto the platform. Well, we're gonna help the dwarf, of course. A dwarf is a dwarf, of course, and nobody can talk to a dwarf, of course. I don't know. Balls that up, obviously. The Drakkar is strangling the dwarf. As he catches sight of you, he releases his grip and smashes his mailed fist into the dwarf's face, sending him tumbling into space. Dwarf version of the Wilhelm scream. You are inflamed by this cold-blooded murder. You draw your weapon and attack. Due to the speed of your attack, do not deduct any of your own endurance points in the first round of combat. Alright, I got my sword back. I got my shit. Drakkar, you're about to get punked, sir. Mind blast and everything. Alright, round one, 26-25. I lost 2, but I don't really lose 2 because of this. He lost 11. Alright, round 2. Round 2, I just aced him without even getting hurt. This sword is so fucking overpowered. Especially now that I also have a shield, which gives me 2 more combat skill, and I have Mind Blast, which gives me 2 more, unless they're immune to it. I'm kind of OP at this point. Like, the fights were much harder in the first book before I had the powerful sword and all the cool stuff. Alright. If I win the combat, turn to 213. I won the combat. Thanks for playing. And I heal myself. The Drakkar falls to his knees and makes a horrible rasping noise as he tries in vain to prize open his shattered death mask. Your blows have staved in his helm, and the buckled metal has fractured his skull. You lash out with your foot and kick him from the outrigger, sending him spiraling down to Lake Inrahim to join the dwarf he murdered. But the dwarf is neither dead nor hundreds of feet below. He hangs by his foot, unconscious, snagged in the netting below the outrigger boards. You grab the dwarf's leg and haul him to safety before continuing the fight. Nice. The dwarf lives. The platform looks empty. No heads are showing above its armored parapet, but you sense something is wrong. Instinctively, you leap from the outrigger onto the main hull, your weapon poised to strike. And I gotta fight again. Because there's a combat in this section, I don't get to heal myself. Ducking beneath the boom sail, you clamber onto the platform in time to witness a desperate struggle. The blonde-haired magician is pinned to the deck, his left arm skewered by a spear. With a staff in his right hand, he is trying to fend off the dismounted Kron rider. The Drakkar senses your presence. He whirls round and draws a twisted black scimitar from its scabbard. Alright, so we gotta do this again. No problem. Here we go, round one. Aced! I lost 0 endurance. He lost all 25 of his endurance in one go. See, normally, if you don't have this automated program thing that I have here, the way you have to do these fights is a little bit ridiculous. First of all, you have to use this to pick a random number. This is what was in the actual book. You would have to, like, close your eyes and, like, take a pencil or something and, like, just randomly let it point to one of these numbers. And then once you had your random number, you had to use this table. This crazy table right here. Which shows you how you win or lose. So, like, combat ratio is based on the difference between these numbers. So I have 7 points higher than him. So you look at this one here, that's a positive 7. And depending on what you roll, shows you how much damage the enemy took and how much damage you took. And I must have just rolled a 0, because enemy was instantly killed, and I lost 0. So the random number it must have just rolled for me had to have been a 0, and that's how I got the instant kill result. Alright, I won. Fight lasted 3 rounds. Fight lasted 1 round, son. And I didn't even turn my mind blast on. Alright. The Drakkar curses you with his dying breath, his cry fading as he falls from the platform. Angry cursing, Wilhelm screamed. You rush to aid your wounded countrymen, but the battle is not yet over. A Kron rider is swooping towards you, a crossbow leveled at your head. He fires and the bolt shoots towards your face. Then a shrill, metallic whine rings in your ears as the bolt miraculously ricochets away, deflected by an invisible shield. Thanks, wizard buddy. Fancy running into our pal, the wizard here, in these lands. Also, strange that he's just randomly got a flying ship. Alright, I can heal myself on this one. Bainton lowers his staff, the trace of a wry smile on his pain-racked face.
"Alas, I was too slow to protect myself, Lone Wolf," he says, glancing at his arm.
You kneel at his side and free the spear that pins him to the floor. The wound is serious. Hastily, you staunch the bleeding with strips of cloth torn from his dark blue robes. You recognize the robes, for they are the attire of a journey master. It seems that young Bainden has achieved distinction among his brother magicians since last you met.
"It appears that we are fated to meet in their company," he says, still watching the Kron riders anxiously. "Help me to my feet. We must escape before they drag us from the sky."
You support the magician as he grasps the ship's helm, a radiant crystal sphere with hundreds of glowing facets set on a slim silver rod. No sooner has his hand closed around the crystal than there is a tremendous explosion. All right, let's see if we can escape here. I remember that picture. The explosion is followed by a huge cloud of smoke, which engulfs a cabin perched on the rear deck. As the noise rumbles across the desolate salt plain, you hear the agonizing shriek of a wounded Kron. It spirals past the platform, a ragged hole rent in its broken wing. Here's the dwarf. I remember this image. So many of these illustrations from these books, I remember looking at them a lot when I was a kid, and some of them really stuck with me, like this one, with his one tooth that's all fucked up. And this is the crazy part. Why does he have a feather pierced through the skin of his forehead? What the fuck is that? Like, hey, fuck metal piercings. I use a feather, motherfucker. Like, and it's not just stuck through a little hole either. Like, these big long slits have been carved for this whole big flap of flesh to have be. I mean, that's crazy town. It's, look at the look on his face, too. That dude looks like he's either stoned or straight up insane. And he has a gun, of course. Because in this world, dwarves use guns. That's their thing. The smoke clears to reveal the grinning face of a dwarf at the cabin window. A smear of soot blackens his rosy cheeks and exaggerates the whiteness of his crooked teeth. He is holding a tube of smoking steel that you assume to be a magic staff until you notice that each of the dwarf crew carry identical staves. As they point them at the swooping Kron, gouts of smoke and flame bellow from their tips. Suddenly you recognize the weapons and their wielders. They are dwarves from the mountain kingdom of Bor, armed with one of the inventions for which these ingenious artisans are justly famous throughout Magnemund. These are artisanal weapons. The Kron are terrified by the noise. They turn their leathery tails and fly away, their Drakkarim riders powerless to stop them. The primitive guns have claimed only one victim, but nevertheless, they have driven off the enemy and saved the skyship from disaster. I'm pretty sure I could have just killed all the Drakkarim if they came and landed on the ship. I'm just saying. I'm kind of overpowered. Bainden steers the craft about, banking steeply until the ship faces the darkening peaks of the southern mountains and the distinct V-shaped cleft of the Dahir Pass. Random number time, huh? I bet 0 to 2 means something terrible happens. I got a 9. Alright, that's not bad. The dwarves are clearing the deck of battle debris. A dead Drakkar lies sprawled face down across a pile of chests and sacks roped beneath the boom sail. As the dwarves grab his legs to cast him over the side, he suddenly springs to life, sending the dwarves tumbling in all directions. He screams like a fiend, his black axe cutting a wide arc around his blood-smeared body. A curse, vile and evil, echoes from his death mask as he draws back the axe to throw. His target is you. I have both hunting and sixth sense, so I don't think this is gonna work, buddy. I'm gonna detect your shit. You dive aside, your Kai skill saving you from the axe that is spinning towards the platform. Suddenly, a deafening bang rings out, and the Drakkar is flung backwards, his breastplate torn open by dwarf shot. He gives a long, agonizing death cry as he disappears from sight, tumbling into the darkness that surrounds the speeding skyship. As if in answer to the shot, a menacing roll of thunder rumbles across the darkening plain from Barakish. It is as if the city itself were cursing your escape. Bangdon appears at your side, his face lined with concern. As he offers a shaky hand to help you to your feet, you notice that the makeshift bandage which binds his wound is soaked with blood. He is pale and weak and close to collapse. I have healing. Let's do some healing. Healing is the absolute best one you can take. If you ever play these books, starting in book one, always get healing first, because it's amazing. Because you get to heal yourself 1 point for every single section you go through, as long as there's not a combat. Plus, sometimes you get to heal people like this. Clasping your hands around Bandon's injured arm, you concentrate your Kai skill on healing the torn muscle and splintered bone. The warmth of your healing power numbs the pain and repairs the internal damage sufficiently to be able to remove the blood-soaked strips of cloth. The wound is still open, but you have saved the limb. "We'll help him now, Lone Wolf," shouts a strange voice. You are surprised by this bold claim and turn around to discover who has made it. Take a drink real quick. Two dwarves clamber onto the platform and hurry to their young captain's side. One flicks open a red velvet satchel strapped to his barrel-like chest and removes a glass vial and a clean linen bandage. They attend to the wound, and as his strength returns, Bandon listens intently to your account of the terrifying events that have led up to this meeting. As you conclude your woeful tale, Bandon speaks, his voice full of grim determination.
"The future of Summerland rests in our hands, Lone Wolf. We must stop Dark Lord Hakon from destroying the Book of the Magna Kai. I have heard tell of the Tomb of the Mahan from the nomads of the Dry Main. They say it is a terrible place, a place of horror and death. For what little there is left to die there. It lies beyond the Dahir, near the oasis of Baal Laftan. That is all I know. For the Mahan hid their tombs well, and what few traces remained have long since disappeared beneath the shifting sands of the Dry Main."
Alright, Oasis of Baal Laftan. His face, your face, conveys the disappointment you hear upon hearing these... Wow. I just fucking butchered that sentence. Let's try again. Your face conveys the disappointment you feel upon hearing these words.
"However, all is not lost," says Bandon, undaunted. "There is a man who can guide us there. His name is Tipasa Edoruk, Tipasa the Wanderer. It is he who we must seek, for he is the only man who has ever entered the Tomb of the Mahan and lived to tell the tale."
Okay. Let me see something real quick. These oases are not labeled with names on this map. This reminds you of a Saint Bernard in the snowy wilderness with the barrel of liquor around his neck. Yeah, exactly! Exactly! It kind of made me think of that too. Bandon takes over the helm as his extraordinary ship, the Sky Rider, as the dwarves call it, speeds through the gathering darkness towards the Dahir Pass. Visibility diminishes with each passing minute until, finally, you can see no further than the outriggers. You feel uneasy. If the Sky Rider veers but a fraction off course, you will be smashed to pieces against the mountainside.
"Do not worry, Lone Wolf," says Nolren, the dwarf with the velvet satchel. "The captain will see us through!"
Bandon stands with his hand resting lightly on the glowing crystal, relaxed as if in a trance. His eyes are closed, and a crackle of energy, like fine white lightning, traces an intricate pattern over his forehead and temples. this book is older than you, Boss Pie, but for Nox, it seems like it was yesterday. Lols, it came out. What are you saying, Nox is really old, or what? ''85, man, that's a long fucking time ago now. I was 8 years old. I was 8 years old when this came out. Although I was probably nine years old, maybe even 10 when I read it. No, I think I was probably 9 years old when I first read this. I was really smart 9 year old though. My reading level was really high, so I could read stuff like this and understand it. The dwarf leads you to the cabin at the rear of the craft, where the crew are excitedly recounting their victory over the Kron Riders. They are seated about a table cluttered with plates of steaming food and jugs of foaming ale. The rich smell of spiced meat and boar brew fills your nostrils, reminding you of how ravenously hungry you are. Yeah, I don't think I've eaten at all in this book. You apply for Social Security? It would have been for, yeah, right? Ancient. We're ancient. You make short work of the meat and marrow placed before you. Restore 3 endurance points. Don't need it, but thanks. However, you are unsure about accepting a jug of ale. Boar brew is so strong that in many cities of Magnamund it has been banned for fear of the havoc it can cause. That's awesome. Fuck it. It's gotta be way more fun to drink this stuff than not to, right? I mean, it's probably not smart, but I'm doing it. The ale is thick and creamy, with a taste like malted apples. You lower the half-empty tankard and wipe away the froth from your lips with your sleeve. Pick a random number. If your current endurance point total is less than 15, deduct 2. If your endurance point total is above 25, add 2. If you've reached the Kai rank of Savant, which I have, which is the highest rank you could possibly have reached right now, it's rank 9 out of 10. Add 3 to this number. So I get to add 5. And I want to get a 7, apparently. So all I need to do is roll a 2 or higher. I got an 8, no problem. Something probably terrible happens if you get below 7. The dwarves continue their meal, pausing only to light large hooded pipes. Through the bluish hue of the pipe smoke that clouds the low cabin roof, you notice that they are casting nervous glances at you, as if you might explode at any moment. After 5 minutes have passed, Nolrim raises his tankard and proclaims a toast. To Lone Wolf, a man among dwarves! The dwarves guffaw at Nolrim's wry toast and raise their tankards in a salute to your courage and fortitude. The boar brew has loosened their tongues, and they are eager to tell you of their past exploits. Nice. I'm glad I drank it. Tongues being loosened and anything. You learn that the dwarves were once the crew of a more conventional vessel, a merchantman that sailed the Tentarias of southern Magnamund. The Tentarias is a vast expanse of lakes and landlocked seas, which connect to form a continuous canal stretching nearly 3,000 miles. They were created, as was the Rime Rift of Durinor, by a massive landslide. 3 years ago, the dwarves' former captain, a dwarf named Quan, lost his ship, cargo, and crew whilst gambling at cards. It seems the unfortunate captain was unaware of Baindon's true profession until it was far too late. As a result, Baindon became the dwarves' captain, and ever since they have adventured with him across the lands and skies of southern Magnamund. The Skyrider itself was given to Baindon by the magicians of Desi in return for his help in defeating the Gagadoth, a monstrous creature that terrorized their land, over which their own sorcery could not prevail. The Skyrider was traveling from Desi on its way to Barakish when you appeared. The dwarves have overheard your talk with Baindon and are excited by the prospects of a new adventure. They seem undaunted by the deadly dangers that it will certainly involve. Yeah, deadly dangers are just part of the deal. You know, you can't really let deadly dangers get you down. Just take the deadly dangers with the good, you know. It's what you gotta do. No problems. Sounds like Dragon's Breath from Quest for Glory 1. I'm pretty sure I played Quest for Glory 1, but I was so young, I just don't remember it at all. I remember Quest for Glory 4 a little bit more, but I still don't remember it that well. The fatigue of your ordeal finally catches up with you. You are finding it impossible to keep your eyes open. Norum shows you to a bunk in the hall of the Skyrider. Gratefully, you climb into bed and pull the blankets over your aching limbs. Norum apologizes that the bunk is too short, but his words fall on deaf ears. You are already asleep. Restore 2 endurance points for this much-needed rest. Yes, finally, I finally got to eat and rest. It's been a long time in this book without doing those things. Hashtag old, I know, right? You wake shortly after dawn to the sound of snoring dwarves and the low hum of the Skyrider. Gathering your equipment, you climb on deck to find everything in shadow, for the Skyrider is hovering beneath the massive outcrop of sandstone that juts out from the side of a mountain, thousands of feet above the valley floor below. Baenden stands at the helm, but he is no longer in a trance. "Kron riders," he says, pointing to the sun-bleached valley beyond the shadows. "They arrived with the dawn." You stare out across this alien landscape, a mountain valley filled with pillars of massive and precariously balanced boulders. The Vasagonians call this place the Coos, the Needles. The rocky columns reach so high into the sky that an avalanche seems unavoidable. Perched upon 2 of the columns are Kron, their Drakkarim riders scouring the valley with telescopes. An hour passes before they take to the air and disappear. "Trim the boom sail, Bosun Nolrim," orders Baenden, his voice barely audible above the increasing hum of the Sky Rider. "We've a fast run ahead." A black crystal cube is not a thing which I possess. Unfortunately. I have a towel, though. Can I put my towel to use here? The voyage through the Coos is breathtaking. The Skyrider glides between the towers of rock that rise from the valley floor with fantastic and unearthly grandeur. Far below, sulfurous water bubbles from fissures in the orange ground, and streams of hissing lava carve circular channels which glow like motes of liquid fire. You watch the sky, but there are no signs of the enemy. "Ikaresh," says Baenden pensively. "The Eagle's Glare, that is where we will find Tipasa the Wanderer. It is the place of his birth and the home of his family. He roams the dry main, but he always returns to Ikaresh." It is late afternoon when you reach the hills beyond the Coos that overlook the town of Ikaresh. Baenden moors the Skyrider to a pinnacle of stone, and a rope ladder is lowered to the ground. It has been decided that you and he will enter Ikaresh on foot and locate Tipasa, while Nolrum and the crew wait in hiding for you to return. The sight of the Skyrider hovering above the mountain town would be sure to arouse unwanted interest in your arrival. You and Baenden prepare yourselves for your mission by staining your skins with brown kapala berries and dressing in the gray and white robes commonly worn by the mountain people of this region. You bid farewell to Nolrim and set off across the barren hills. So we're pulling a soul man here. Trust us, we're brown. We're hella brown. Alright, well, let's pick a random number here. An 8. Alright, that's probably good. You trudge through the loose red sand, your faces covered to protect them from the dust and the blazing heat. The landscape is stark and desolate. All that seems to thrive here is the wire-hard grass that scratches your boots and leggings. You soon come across a dried riverbed that leads to a cave in the orange sandstone hillside. A wooden plaque is nailed by the mouth of the cave, but you are unable to understand the strange words painted on its sun-blistered surface. Let's investigate the cave, right? I mean, just because that sounds awesome. Rows of stalactites hang from the roof of the cave, like the fangs of some incredible monster, and the bubbling of a distant geyser echoes eerily through the unknown depths. You begin to explore and eventually reach a place where a natural bridge of rock arches over a steaming course of water, red with ore. Huddled beneath the bridge is a pathetic figure, its body bent and emaciated. A tattered blanket covers his face, and in his withered hands he clutches a crude fishing rod, its golem. A small catch of lava crabs lies on the bank, their claws twitching as they slowly die. As you move nearer, the figure raises his face to stare at you. It is a man, but the sight of his face shocks you to the core. I have healing. The old man's face is a mask of putrescent green sores. Oh, he's like a leper or something. The pupils of his eyes are yellow, and his ragged gray lips hang in tatters. He suffers from vaxillus, an infectious disease that rots the skin and attacks the nerves, resulting in hideous mutilation and deformity. He has been cast from his community, banished to this cave where he must eke out his last few years of life in misery and solitude. Well, that sucks for him. Life is not good for this guy. I do not possess any oid herb. Unfortunately, I don't have any of that herb. I would totally share my herb with this dude. This could turn into section 420, but I don't have any herb. Sorry, guy. Or if you just don't want to give it to this unfortunate wretch. Yeah, alright, well, bye, leper dude. You race along the rock-strewn cave, eager to escape from the infected old man. The horrific stories that you have heard about Vaxilus makes you careless in your haste, and you lose two items from your backpack. The fuck? Alright. Choose which two items to erase from your action chart. Alright, well, I don't want to lose the towel, but I probably should. These things all count as two items. I should lose the pick. I probably won't need a pick anytime soon. I'm losing the pick. Just say you do? Nah. Once outside the cave, you and Bandon waste no time in pressing on towards Icaresh. As you near the outskirts of the town, you pass a small round hut where a goat is eating from a manger near the door. A man appears in the darkened doorway and bids you welcome. He touches his forehead in a salute of friendship and invites you to enter his humble home. Sixth sense this shit. You sense that the man's show of friendship is genuine. He may be able to help you find Tipasa the Wanderer if you accept his hospitality. I'll enter his house. The man is short of stature but broad-shouldered and strongly built, physical characteristics common among the tough mountain dwellers in Vasagonia. He pulls a cork from a bottle of lime-green wine and pours three large measures into earthenware cups. Gursha! He exclaims and downs the wine in one swift gulp. I'll drink the strange wine. What the fuck? I'm adventurous. Despite your misgivings, the lime green wine tastes delicious. A warm glow radiates slowly from your stomach, filling you with a comfortable sense of well-being. Restore two endurance points. Don't need to. The man looks delighted by your reaction to his wine and offers to sell you the bottle for 5 gold crowns. If you wish to buy the bottle of Kursha, pay the man 5 gold crowns and make the necessary adjustments to your action chart. There's enough Kursha in the bottle to restore a further 4 endurance points. Well, I just made some space in my... Screw it, I almost never get to spend money. Like, I almost never ever get to spend crowns on anything, so I'm gonna buy it. Alright, I'm gonna question him about Tapasa the Wanderer.
Ah, Tapasa, he replies thoughtfully. He lives near the Duga Market, but exactly where his home is, I am not sure. I haven't seen old Tapasa for years. If you should find him, remind him of come seeing the goat herd. He still owes me 12 crowns that I have not forgotten.
You thank the goat herd for his help and bid him farewell before continuing your trek to Ikaresh. So near the Duga Market, you follow a path along a dry gully, the bed of an ancient river that once flowed through the mountains. An arid breeze blows eddies of red dust along the banks of dead earth. The white-walled buildings of Ikaresh suddenly appear, and as the dust settles, you find yourself standing in a small square close to the open archway of the town's east gate. Perched upon a tall basalt monolith in the center of the square is an eagle, the emblem of this mountain town, cast in bronze. Three bronze arrows are held in its beak, each indicating an exit from the square. So towards the Duga Market, toward the main square, or south toward along the Avenue of Eagles. I mean, it'd be kind of cool just to go randomly some wrong way to explore the town, but I know I'm supposed to go toward the Duga Market. Kind of feel like exploring, though. Not gonna lie to you. I mean, surely I'll find the guy eventually anyway, right? I'm gonna go to the main square. Alright, this might have been a bad idea. You soon enter a public square where a throng of men have gathered at the ruins of a fountain. They are listening to the frenzied speech of a man dressed in red from head to toe. Each man in the crowd is wearing a strip of the same colored cloth, which covers the lower half of his face.
They're Adukal, the Veiled Ones, says Baindon nervously. It sounds as if they're declaring a blood feud on their old enemies, the men of Tefa.
You follow Baindon to the shelter of a Toa tree, where you will be less conspicuous. The speaker is denouncing the Tefarim for imposing a heavy tax for safe passage through their town and for use of the highway to Caracalla. His ranting begins to stir the crowd to fever pitch. Suddenly, he points to where you stand and shrieks, "Tefarim spies!" If you want to try to reason with the crowd of screaming fanatics that are now running towards you with their swords drawn, that's gotta be an instant death. That's probably a horrible decision. Or follow Baindon's example and run for your life. I'm gonna do it. I haven't died yet in this book. In every book except for book 3, I've died once from an instant death decision. I gotta try this one. I gotta try to reason with them. There's no way this ends well, though. You call out to them to stop, but your accent merely confirms their suspicions that you are a spy. A rock hurtles through the air and gashes your forehead. You lose 3 endurance points. Well, it was an instant death.
Run, lone wolf! Screams Baindon. They will cut you to pieces!
As they race nearer, the crazed look in their eyes quickly tells you it would be madness to stay. You turn and run for all you're worth. Alright, fair enough. It takes over an hour to shake off the Aduka, by which time you have been chased through most of Ikaresh. Had it not been for Baindon's timely casting of a spell of illusion, they would be after you still. You cannot help but laugh when you picture their faces, when they saw the Kalkoth leaping at them. Thank the gods, they did not think to question how a cult ice beast came to be roaming the streets of their town. I fought a Kalkoth in book 3 when I was in cult. I fought one and I killed it. When you have fully recovered from the chase, you leave the narrow alley in which you have been hiding and press on in search of Tapasa the Wanderer. I can heal myself right here. You pass under an arch where 2 brass-gilded conical towers gleam like gold and enter a marketplace crowded with squabbling merchants. Exotic carpets, brightly colored material, and all manner of foods are being bought, sold, and haggled over. The north side of the marketplace is devoted to the auction of dugas.
The sleek but noisy desert beasts are being paraded, for the benefit of the bidders, around a paddock adjoining their stables. Just past the stables, a street vanishes into the carpet weaver's quarter of Icaresh. The carpet weaver's quarter, huh? I don't need any carpets. Investigate the stables, ask one of the merchants. Let's check out the stables. As you enter the stables, you are overpowered by the smell of the dugas. You grit your teeth and cover your nose with your robe. A small boy sniggers at your reaction and says,
"You're not Icarishi, I can tell!"
He mimics your grimace, exposing a line of broken teeth.
"Do you know where Tipasa the Wanderer lives?" asks Bainden, holding up a silver ring.
The boy's eyes nearly pop out of his head at the sight of the gleaming silver.
"Oh yes, yes, yes I do indeed!"
he stammers in his excitement.
"Walk up the street and take the first passage on your left! The old wanderer lives at the house with the blue door!"
Bandon flicks the ring into the air and the urchin catches it in his grubby hands. You hurry away from the stables and begin to search for the passageway. Just as you find it, you hear the young boy shriek with disappointment. The ring is just dissolved on his finger. "Oh, that's fucked up, Bandon! Giving the little kid an illusionary ring? That's how you do urchins? I mean, I could have given him like a real coin or two. You didn't have to pull that dick move." At the end of the rubbish-strewn alley, you find a house with the blue door. That's cold! That is fucking cold. Poor little, like, urchin boy that's probably, like, starving and shit. Trick him like that. Bandon's a cold motherfucker. Alright, let me heal myself up to 28 here. We made it to Dude's house. There was no reply to your first knock. You are about to knock again when the door opens a few inches and the red-rimmed eyes of an old woman stare out from the darkness.
"Bandon!"
she exclaims, her voice hoarse and shaky.
"Thank the gods it is you!"
Could have given him a towel. Well, let's not get too generous here. I don't just be handing out towels all willy-nilly. She ushers you both inside and locks the door. The house is sparsely furnished, and what little is there is either damaged or broken.
"They have taken him, Bandon! They've taken my husband! The men with the faces of the dead! 10 days ago, they came like shadows in the night."
She breaks down, her frail body racked by sobs. Bandon's probably going to trick her into thinking he gave her something. Bandon comforts her as best he can, but you sense he shares her bitter loss. The Drakkarim have taken Tipasa, of that there is little doubt. By now, they will have made him tell everything he knows about the Tomb of the Mahan.
"We will find him, I promise," says Bandon, wiping the tears from the old woman's face. "But you must try to help us if you can. Tipasa always kept a diary of his travels. Do you have it still?"
A flicker of hope shines in the old woman's eyes.
"Yes, it is here. He told me to hide it when the evil men came for him."
She kneels at an empty fireplace and prizes a loose brick from the chimney. A leather-bound book drops from its hiding place into her hand. She gives it to Bandon, who studies the yellowed pages, his face lined in thought. You notice that the book is full of cryptic symbols, numbers, and pictograms.
"They are drawn by the night stars," says Bandon, tracing his finger along the astronomical drawings. "They hold the secret, I know, but without my star charts, we cannot hope to find the tomb. We must return to the Skyrider at first light. There I shall be able to make some sense of this book."
Alright. Gotta take it back to the ship and make some sense out of it with star charts. Sure, sometimes you gotta do that. You sure you wanna maybe make this poor woman believe that you've given her something? And then, you know, laugh? Just make an illusion of her husband coming back? Walking in the door?
and she gets all that hope and shit, and then he just disappears. You sure you don't want to do that, Bandon? Because that'd be kind of right up your alley, I guess. Alright, let's go. You have little sleep that night as you lie thinking about the quest that lies before you, haunted by the fear that the Dark Lords may already have found the Book of the Magna Chi. You rise before dawn and breakfast on a meal of sheep's butter and dried milk cake. That sounds interesting. Before bidding farewell to Tapas's wife, the trek back to the Skyrider passes uneventfully, and by noon you have reached the rocky crag where the craft is moored. Nolrim is the first to greet you, but he cannot hide his disappointment that you have returned unaccompanied. "Do not worry, the answer lies here," says Bandon, holding up Tapas's diary. "Prepare to set sail." As the Skyrider rises into the clear blue sky, Bandon hands over the helm to Nolrim and bids you follow him to his quarters at the prow. For 3 hours he pores over his charts, making calculations, checking instrument readings, and racking his brain for the solution that will pinpoint the tomb of the Mahan. "It's no use," he says, tired and exasperated. "I cannot fathom these numbers." As you peer at the pages of Tapas's diary, suddenly you realize that they are written in code. What Bandon had assumed to be positions of stars is a code to 3 numbers that give the precise location of the tomb. Consult the map to help you discover the location of the tomb of the Mahan. The first of the 3 numbers is equal to the number of oases on the trail between Ikaresh and Bir Rabalu. The second number is equal to the number of cities in Vasagonia. The third number is equal to the number of islands off the coast of Cape Kabar. When you've broken the code, write the numbers in order and turn to the entry number that they indicate. Oh, this is a legit little puzzle. I mean, this should be pretty easy to figure out, but it says, to solve this puzzle, you'll need to use the map of the Empire of Vasagonia with the code instructions in mind before coming back to this section. The section corresponding to the correct answer will have a footnote confirming that it is indeed correct. Okay. First of all, we need to know number of oases between Ikaresh and Bir Rabalu. Where's Ikaresh? I don't even know where the hell Ikaresh is. Up here, I guess. Bir Rabalu's down over here. I guess you can't see it because it's under the book, but whatever. There's 1, 2, 3. There's 3 oases. So the first number is 3. Number of cities in Vasagonia. What do they consider cities? I guess they're just the big cities with the flags above them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I see 6. But I thought they said earlier that there were 7 cities. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I see 6. So we're looking at 3 and 6, but it could be 3 and 7. Number of islands off the coast of Cape Kabar. Cape Kabar is over here. There's 3 islands. So it's either 363 or 373. It's like that popular game, Wherein Karash is Carmen Sandiego. Yeah, Wherein Ikaresh is Car... Yeah, exactly. It is exactly like that. So I'm going to try 363 first, but it might be 373. Nope, it's not 363. So it's 373. This is the correct answer, it says. Okay, cool. "That's it!" exclaims Bandon, stabbing his finger at a map of the dry main that covers his chart table. 115 miles due west of Bir Rabalu, 115 miles due south of the oasis of Baal Lofton. He picks up a quill pen and marks the spot. The tomb of the Mahan. You study the map and ponder the miles of desolation separating you from your goal. Bandon notices your look of dismay and quickly tries to put your mind at ease.
Fear not, Lone Wolf. We'll be there before the dawn. Yeah, we have a fucking flying ship. I'm not really concerned about the journey.
You smile at his confidence, but it is not the actual journey that worries you. Your concern is what you may or may not find upon your arrival. Dawn is breaking on the horizon of a low hill, blurred and dotted with small tufted trees. Swiftly, the Sky Rider has voyaged through the night to arrive at the foothills of the Koneshi Mountains, in whose folds the skyship is safely tucked away from watchful eyes. 25 miles to the north, across a landscape of barren rock and dry brush, lies the tomb of the Mahan. We got a flying ship, and we're stopping we gotta still go hike 25 fucking miles through the desert? Seriously? Alright, I mean, seriously though? Can't we halo jump out of the airship down to the, I can use my towel as a parachute. It's been done. Miles to the north, across a landscape of barren rock and dry brush, lies the tomb of the Mahan. You and Bandon set off before the dawn, anxious not to waste either time or the protective cover of darkness. Now, as the great golden disk of the sun rises in the sky, for the first time you can see your goal. A massive excavation has exposed the heart of this scorched land, delving deep around the tombs of its forgotten ancestors. Thousands of Geaks, spiteful and malicious servants of the Dark Lords, labor unceasingly to remove rock and sand from this quarry, forced by Drakkarim to drag their back-breaking loads up ramps to the rim of the crater. Yeah, it would take a day, and a serious day, too. I mean, depending on how rocky and hilly the terrain is. We're starting in the mountains, too. So who knows how many miles worth of actual mountains we have to hike through. It would take a serious day of hiking. Call an ass. So I'm thinking of Indiana Jones right now, with like all the massive excavations around the, you know, in the desert. In Raiders of the Lost Ark. Close to the edge of the crater, an encampment of black tents surrounds a large domed canopy. Lying in the shade of this construction is a huge flying creature, an Imperial Zlan beast. Its presence here can only mean one thing. Dark Lord Hakan has arrived. The thought chills your blood, but you draw comfort from the labor of his slaves. That they continue to labor is a sign that their mission has yet to be completed. The Book of the Magna Chi has yet to be found. It is impossible to approach the crater unseen. You will have to wait for darkness before you attempt to enter the tomb. During the long wait, it is agreed that Bandon should attempt to find Tipasa. It is likely that he is being held captive inside the encampment. The Dark Lords would be unlikely to kill him before discovering the treasure they seek. Right, try to find Tipasa. I mean, we already found the tomb, so do we really need that guy? I'm just saying, like, I mean, we already found the place. We don't really need Tipasa. I suppose if we happen to stumble upon him, we could free him, but we have to consider that a side quest at best right now. During the day, you must eat a meal or lose 3 endurance points. You may not use hunting if required to eat a meal in the middle of this wasteland. So I do not have a meal. I do have hunting, but I'm not allowed to use it because we're in a crazy desert. So I'm going to lose 3 endurance. But it's okay because I can just heal myself of that damage anyway. That's why I don't really bother to carry meals. Unless I have, you know, extra backpack space with nothing to do with it. As night falls, your desperate quest begins. The Geaks pose few problems that you cannot overcome with your warrior skills, for they have been overworked to the point of exhaustion. Only the Drakarim show any sign of vigilance, but even then there are less than a dozen patrolling the entire crater. Not until you reach the main entrance to the tomb do you encounter any real difficulty. I could drink that liquor instead. Yeah, I could. I mean, I don't need to because my health just comes back automatically. Basically, I have the potion and that I could use it if I had a fight that was really hard and I lost a ton of endurance and I only had a little bit left over after the fight, then I would use something like that to get me back up, you know, in case I had to do another fight. Like that happened in the first book. I almost died because one fight was really hard and it got me down to like one or two endurance, and then I had to do another fight pretty soon after that, and I almost died. A Drakkar stands on guard, his cruel eyes glinting behind his twisted iron death mask. Occasionally, he diverts his attention from the watch to take a drink from a water flask. I have mind over... Oh man, we've been using mind over matter a lot in this book. This is like the fourth time. You focus your skill on a nearby spade, willing the spade handle to rattle against the wheelbarrow in which it rests. It only takes a few seconds for the vigilant Drakkarim sentry to leave his post and investigate the noise. By the time he returns, you are inside the tomb of the Mahan. Nice. Use the old noisemaker trick. $3.95. Motherfucker! I mean, I had a blue stone triangle at the beginning of this. I got it in called in book 3 and I threw it away. I got rid of it a little while ago because I'm like, I'm never going to use this blue stone triangle. Anyway, let's go back here. As far as the eye can see, a long straight sandstone corridor slopes away into the distance. Torches cracker. Wow, I'm having a problem here. Torches crackle and sputter on the walls, illuminating the pictograms engraved in the yellow stone. At regular intervals, rough-edged slabs protrude into the main corridor. You stop to take a close look at one of these slabs and the floor beneath it, and come to a frightening conclusion. They are obviously traps, no doubt set off by the Geaks when they cleared this corridor of sand. Rather than instructing the Geaks to avoid them, the Dark Lords must have deliberately used their slaves to set them off. Once the traps had been sprung, the squashed bodies were cleared away and the slabs chiseled through to the next section. Pit traps in the floors seem to have been neutralized in the same way. Set off by luckless Geaks, they would have been filled in with the dead bodies and leveled off with sand. The thought of this heartless barbarity fills you with revulsion. I mean, they are called the Dark Lords for a reason. Like, discovering that the Dark Lords did some evil shit is not exactly a huge surprise. Just over a mile along the corridor, you eventually arrive at a large stone door. The stone surround bears evidence of chisel work, but the door itself is rock solid. You notice a faint beam of light descending from a hole in the ceiling. This is so Indiana Jones right now. I just need to have the staff that I hold with the beam of light shining through it. This is totally Raiders of the Lost Ark. What year did Raiders of the Lost Ark come out? I think it came out pretty close to around 1985 when this was written. Maybe a little bit earlier than 1985. It was in the early 80s, I'm pretty sure. This has to be, like, kind of a reference to it, or inspired by it. You notice a faint beam of light descending from a hole in the ceiling. It creates a small circular pool of light, a little to one side of a similar hole in the floor. In the wall near to the door, there is a triangular indentation, no larger than a gold crown. Can't believe I got rid of my blue stone triangle and now I can use it again. I mean, it's okay, because I did take a prism. So I have a prism, but still. Holding the prism in the center of the beam, you divert the light toward the hole in the floor. You hear the sound of stone grating on stone as the door slowly opens to reveal a large chamber. It is dimly lit, but in the dust that covers the marble floor, you can see footprints too numerous to count. As you enter, you suddenly catch sight of a rough stone throne facing the wall on the far side of the chamber. Behind you, the door slides shut with unnerving speed. Great. The throne begins to revolve. A terrible howling fills your ears, changing almost instantaneously. Where's my music? I need some music in the background of this business. Oh, the playlist ended. Okay, sure. Sure it did. Alright. Oops. Okay, here we go. The throne begins to revolve. A terrible howling fills your ears, changing almost instantaneously to the growling of a harsh, guttural language, the like of which you have never heard before. Words and sounds that the mouths of men could never be shaped to speak roll through the chamber like thunder. It is the Dark Tongue, spoken by Hakon, Lord of Arnak, Dark Lord of Helgadad. He rises from the throne, the ghastly voice still echoing from his unnatural mouth. A spiked fist opens to reveal a glowing stone. Blue flame smolders around its surface, and you can feel the currents of power that radiate from its core. Suddenly, his words change, and you hear a tongue you know so well, Somlending.
Look on your doom, Kai Lord!
There is a deafening crack, a surge of power, and a fireball of blue flame hurtles towards your head. Oh, didn't you know I got the Sommer Sword and it absorbs magic, son? You raise your golden sword just in time to deflect the bolt of raw energy. It screams from your blade and explodes into the chamber wall, gouging a hole several feet deep into the steel-hard rock. The impact jars the Sommer Sword from your hand. The blade arcs through the dust-choked air and embeds itself upright in the stone floor. You roll across the floor and take cover behind a pillar. That is not good. I just lost my super badass sword of awesomeness.
Your doom, Kai Lord,
spits Hakon,
is but seconds away.
I wish to retrieve the Sommer Sword is really what needs to happen. You run, half-crouched, towards your golden blade, grab the hilt, and continue at full speed towards the cover of another pillar. Suddenly, a burst of energy leaps from the Dark Lord's fist, exploding into the base of the pillar, severing it from the floor. A tremendous roar fills your ears as you are thrown backwards by the shock of the blast. You lose 3 endurance points. Hakon's laugh rises above the crash of falling stone until your head is filled with an agonizing pain. I have Mind Shield, and I'm really glad I do right now. And I gotta fight some shit. Suddenly, the pain subsides, but the onslaught has only just begun. A mist as black as the grave is seeping from Hakon's mouth. It creeps along his outstretched arm and settles like a cloud in the palm of his upturned hand. Whirling shadow shapes draw into focus. Wings and tentacles sprout and take form. A curse in the Dark Tongue shakes the whole chamber as a deadly flood of horror hurtles from his hand. Little bit of alliteration there. Crypt Spawn. Oh, that thing's reasonably tough. It doesn't say that it's undead either, so I don't get to do the double damage from the... But it also doesn't say that it's immune to Mind Blast. Alright, Mind Blast coming on. Here we go. Crypt Spawn versus me. Oh, let's look at the picture. This looks like brains. That totally... These are like brains with tentacles and bat wings. That's some creepy-ass creature, and there's a whole shitload of them, like a swarm of them. A deadly flood of horror hurtles from his hand. Horrifically. Horribly. Hurriedly. Okay. Let's do this, Grip Spawn. Round one. He lost 14. I lost none. Die, Crip Spawn. 25, 26, go. Round 2. Lost 16, I lost none. I am fucking this Crip Spawn up. Not even getting hurt. I didn't get hurt at all. I killed it in 3 rounds. Didn't get hurt at all. Thank you, Mind Blast, for giving me that little bit of edge. That probably helped me out. Okay, I won. What now? As you slay the last of the crypt spawn, Hakan reels back as if weakened by the death of his creatures. You raise the Somersword, willing the blade to discharge a bolt of power that will burn the evil Dark Lord from the face of Magnamund forever. The blade shimmers with golden fire, but no searing blast issues from its tip. Suddenly, you realize what has happened. You are beneath the earth, and there is no sun from which the sword can draw its power. That's a pretty cool picture. That's a pretty cool hilt of a sword. Yeah, that's not bad. A lot of detail in there. Hakan utters a terrible laugh that shakes the floor. A beam of blue flame is growing from the stone in his hand, forming a fiery blade that crackles and spits as it cuts through the dust-choked air. That's awesome. I can totally see that in my head. The stench of death and decay fills your nostrils as the Dark Lord prepares to attack. Alright, he's reasonably tough. Unless you have the Kai Discipline of Mind Shield, reduce your combat skill by 2 for the duration of this combat. Well, it doesn't say he's undead, and it also doesn't say he's immune to Mind Blast, so... pretty standard stuff here. So he actually has slightly more combat skill than me. A lot more intense. I mean, I think I'll still beat him, because the random number system, the results on the chart are skewed in favor of Lone Wolf. But I might actually take some damage here. Alright, round 1. I lost 4, he lost 5. Round 2. I lost 2, he lost 8. Alright, we're doing okay here. Round 3. I lost 5. He lost 2. Did not roll well that time. This is starting to look ugly, actually. Starting to look ugly. Round 4. He lost 6, I lost 3? Round 5. I might lose. I've never lost a fight in any of these books. I mean, since I've been doing them here on stream. For YouTube or whatever. I haven't lost a fight. Round 5. 11 and 24. 8 and 18. He lost 6. I lost 3. Oof. Round 6. Oh! I lost 5. He lost 3. This is not good at all. This is not good at all. I'm gonna lose. Round 7. I died! I died in combat! I mean, at least I died to a Dark Lord, so it's not like I died to some scrub. You can't do that in combat. You have to drink it after a battle, it says. Well, I died. I lost. So, normally what happens when I die is I just go back and make the other decision or I'll just have to do the fight again, essentially. But we all know that I died. I go back to what I had before, which was 25 endurance. Tell the Dark Lord that it can drink it too. Can we just take a break, Dark Lord? I got some stuff I need to drink. You know. Now, if he was undead, I would wreck him, because I would be doing double damage to him with my Somersword, but it doesn't say he's undead. So, lost once. Let's go for round two. Let's try it again and see if I can beat him in my second attempt. Here we go. Round one. Lost 8, I lost 2. That's good. I lost 3. He lost 6. I lost 1. He lost 9 that time. That was a good roll. Round 4. I lost 4. He lost 4. Round 5. I lost none. He lost 11. Okay. That was what we needed right there. So I think I'll beat him this time now. I lost 2. He lost his remaining 7. Dark Lord defeated. This is the first time we've fought a Dark Lord in the whole series of books. And it said he was weakened by me destroying his creatures. So if he had been at full strength... And if I didn't have the Summer Sword, there'd be no fucking way. Because my combat skill would be lower by 8. Which means he would just obliterate me every time. But because I have the sword, I was able to beat him. Well, second try. After I actually died the first time. Alright, that was rough. Excuse me. Alright, turn to 400. That's the final one. We just won the book. Just won the game. You examine the floor where Dark Lord Hakan fell, but there are no signs of his body. The atmosphere is strangely calm and peaceful, as if a great and evil shadow has been lifted. If you lost the Summer Sword in the confrontation with the Dark Lord, you may now retrieve it. Oh man, if I hadn't retrieved the sword, and I would have had to fight him without the sword, there'd be no way. You could not beat him. There's no way. I mean, like... if I rolled up in here with 17 combat skill, what did he have? 28 and 45. This would have been a totally unwinnable fight. Yeah, he beat me, see? Try it again. Would have been totally unwinnable. Yeah, see, easily beats me. So, retrieving the sword was like the smartest possible decision. Okay. Sorry for the little... I just had to check that out and see how that would have gone, and it would have gone badly. You turn and walk to the throne where Hakan sat, waiting for you to appear. Beyond it lies a portal, an ancient inscription carved deep into the blood-red stone. Below the carving is set the impression of a human hand. Instinct and intuition guide your hand to the door. The carving fits around it like a glove. There's the, illustration of the Book of the Magna Chi. That looks pretty cool. Pretty big tome there. Silently, the portal slides back to reveal your destiny, the Book of the Magna Chi. Set on a pedestal, the book lies open, its secrets revealed to your eyes alone. As you lift the sacred book, the very air throbs with the vibration of the force locked within its sun-gold cover. With a pounding heart, you close the book and hurry from the chamber. By the time you reach the foothills of the Koneshi, Bainden has successfully completed his mission. He and Tipasa are waiting for you. As they see you appear, clutching the Book of the Magna Chi, they can barely contain their excitement. "This night of triumph," says Bainden jubilantly, "will herald a new dawn of hope for Summerland. The Chi are reborn." The quest is now over. You have found the Book of the Magna Chi and freed Magnamund from the shadow of Dark Lord Hakan. But for you, Chi Master Lone Wolf, the story has only just begun. Your destiny lies along the path of the Grand Masters. To learn their secrets and attempt the first exciting quest of the Magna Chi, begin your journey with Book 6 of the Lone Wolf series, entitled The Kingdoms of Terror. And see, then you go over here to Magna Chi, and you have a whole new set of abilities you've got to start getting. So, I won. I mean, I did die. Did I have any instant deaths in this from bad decisions? I didn't. I just had one combat death to the main boss at the end. That's the first time that's happened. He straight up killed me. I got some unlucky rolls. If you wish to ignore the sword and press a button that drops an Acme Safe of Doom on the Dark Lord, go to section Hacks. Yeah. Well, I mean, of course, you could always cheat. You could always just, you know, cheat any way you want with these things, really. Well, that brings us to the end of the two-part double book. It's not really double, but a little longer than normal book, Shadow on the Sand. That's book 5. So next time, I will begin on book 6, The Kingdoms of Terror. So thank you for watching. This has been Josiah Plays Lone Wolf, Book 5, Shadow on the Sand.